News US correspondent Mark Stone explains why the position of Speaker is so significant.
The person is the third most powerful politician in the land. It has been a very, very chaotic 4 days. The president a few days ago said it was a global embarrassment that it was taking this long, that there was so much infighting within the Republican Party.
And that's your news at 2 minutes past three.
News Talk weather.
Thanks to Ryanair. Wind and rain got you down? Cheer up in Lanzarote, Tenerife or the Canaries this winter.
Tonight will continue windy, particularly in the west and north. Clear spells and scattered showers, some heavy with a further possibility of hail and thunder. Fresh to strong and gusty southwesterly winds with gales near west and northwest coasts. High seas persisting on western coasts, winds will ease somewhat overnight. Cold with lowest temperatures of 2 to 4 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
Football on off the ball.
With Sky, the Premier League is back. Watch every live game for the rest of the season on Sky Sports, BT Sport and Premier Sports.
This is News Talk.
And you're welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. John Duggan with you through to five on the first football Saturday of 2023. Remember, football on off the ball brought to you by Sky. Get all the football you love in one place across Sky Sports, BT Sport and Premier Sports. We're streaming the conversation as well. You can listen across the country on your radio on News Talk. Also watch us on the digital and social channels. For Periscope and Twitter, at Off the Ball, YouTube, Facebook and on the OTB Sports app. Delighted to be joined in studio by the League of Ireland and FAI Cup winning footballer Graham Gartland, football correspondent of the Irish Independent Dan McDonnell, and the broadcaster and journalist Johnny Ward. You can text us 53106 or you can tweet us at Off the Ball. Happy New Year, everybody. How are we all getting on?
Good, JD.
Yeah, we're good, yeah.
I've been looking at Instagram stories the last few days, and Dan and Johnny, you started the year very well.
Well, I mean, well, it's like it's all downhill from here.
Well, to be clear,
want to talk about your week?
Well, I mean, I could talk about my week. I didn't do a huge amount. I stayed in a hotel last night, quite a nice hotel. Johnny's been down in Kerry, living in a 5-star lap of luxury for the entire week.
Yeah.
Like this is like the first 2 hours of the week he's actually going to
Johnny's Ireland
without being waited on by someone.
I saw him flick his fingers at somebody earlier, just asking for coffee.
And it was 7.70.
Johnny posted up an Instagram post about the wonderful scenery of Kerry. I was like, this is lovely. I clicked into it. It was just a series of meals on a plate. So like,
I showed Dugan there as well.
70% sort of cutlery, 20, you know, 30% scenery.
I was near Bill nice Blaw, JD, where you visited this year. West Cork.
On the 100th day.
On the 100th anniversary, yeah. So no, it was a good trip and... I don't know, I was talking to a guy today about the fact that the League of Ireland is kind of creeping in now and we've got some good news stories for Ireland this
45 seconds
week.
To get a reference in.
Obviously it's FA Cup weekend, but you know, friendlies are only a couple of weeks away and we've a couple of good news stories on the Irish front, I think, this week as well to talk about.
And maybe a cookery programme in the offing.
Who knows? I mean,
Johnny Ward's five-star.
That's where the money is, really, isn't it?
Never mind a cooking program. You just have the whole travel program. You can just Johnny just traveling around Ireland, like into various sort of 5-star venues.
We have an amazing country. I think we should never lose sight of that amazing country.
Yeah, leave him off.
I'd
watch a travelling show that you do.
Me and Paul Doolan.
You and Dan just giving it, you just admiring everything and Dan just telling you to be quiet halfway through.
Yeah, which is probably going to happen the next 2 hours.
Yeah.
Sad news though in the world of football the last 24 hours, Gianluca Vialli passing away, only 58 yesterday, the legendary footballer, Italian national team player, Cremonese, Sampdoria, Juventus and Chelsea, and 275 goals and 732 appearances. And Graham Gartland, very much a loved figure. I think you can see that by all the tributes the last while.
Yeah, I think the affection that he's garnered from the whole football community, more so about how he was as a person rather than was as a footballer, it's very heartwarming and very heartfelt to see, because he's obviously impacted so many people's lives. He comes across as such a warm character and a lovable character, and he brought that love and affection to the game, and he put that into the players and the people that he worked with. I think people of our generation, like that grew up in the 80s, have such a strong affinity towards the Italian league during that era, because it was the Channel 4 game, and you'd watch it on Saturday morning and then you'd watch the game on a Sunday before you might get the Sunday game. And I think we grew up around watching all these players, and the Italian league looked so appealing and they had such great players around at that stage, and he was one of them. And then obviously then I think I'm coming to Chelsea and coming to England originally, and he didn't really play that much when he first came in. I was talking to a good friend of mine today, Michael Dubry, and I rang him on the way in, and he said that he didn't really play that much when he came in, but he never it never changed who he was and his demeanour around the dressing room. He was still very lovable, very likeable, very enthusiastic, brought a joy to the dressing room. He said so whether he was playing or not under Ruud Gullit, he still brought that, and that meant a lot to the players in the dressing room. And then eventually when he took over, he never changed who he was as a manager. He still treated people very fairly. He was still honest with them. He still had a joy about him as a manager. And he was 34, I think, when he took over. I think I was talking to him today. He said he took over his two semi-finals as well when Hullett left, and he got the player-manager's gig, and then he got into the both finals. And he said he was very honest, very upfront, very likable, even though he didn't try and be likable. He just had that character about him. But like you said, I think more so his career as a footballer, I think more so his character. I heard Graham Souness saying he was a beautiful soul.
Yeah, he was in tears yesterday on Sky.
Yeah, and to see someone like Souness be upset about it. I think he was a kid when Souness met Massampdoria and he took him under his wing. But I think when you're at that age and you see the youthfulness and enthusiasm that you come in, it makes you be a kid again. And that sometimes the older players like to be around that. And I just think he brought such a joyous sort of personality to football.
And lads, there was a lovely scene, I think, at the end of the Euros final between himself and Mancini, because they soldiered together at Sampdoria, they were players together, they were both in Italian squads, and for them to have that moment, I think they both knew that Gianluca wasn't that well. It's something very special.
Yeah, I mean, like, I can only really echo what Graham said. I think a lot of the feelings are similar, you know, sort of being of a similar age and watching him at remember him in that way. I was actually just reading up about, like, you know, because of course Souness, the crossover with Souness was in Viale as a young player as well. You know, Viale was only 20, I think Souness said, wasn't he, when they met? So probably when we were watching Viale, he was a little bit older, a little bit more established. But it seems to be, I mean, I know it's always the way, like when someone passes away, like you're honing in on the good stuff, but like you sort of read up on Viale's sort of background, there's not a huge amount of sort of controversy there, you know. There's a for whatever reason, like clearly he settled in the UK in London. He was obviously very happy there. Like he managed Watford after Chelsea. Clearly, I think he got involved in various investment things or whatever, rather than for whatever reason pursuing management. Like maybe you can argue, you know, maybe was he too likable or just didn't need the sort of that drive or demand to just go in and be the manager full time. But clearly, like as you said, Souness very emotional. The generosity of the tributes from elsewhere, even that moment with Mancini that you mentioned, because Mancini even can be a polarizing figure, you sense, you know, with people he's worked with, but there was a genuine warmth and affection. So it's always sad, you know. It's like these things always make you reflect on your own age and you know, when you see sort of people, you know, from your youth, and it's sort of, that's obviously a sobering thought, but
He done Sky Italia, didn't he? He brought the whole, what Sky had done in terms of the Premiership and the broadcasting and all that. I think he brought that to Italy as well and not revolutionised it, but sort of regenerated Sky Italia and made that a bit of a bigger force in Italy. And then obviously he goes into doing the stuff with the Italians, where he becomes organiser and helps Mancini with the Euro. So he'd done a lot as well in terms of, and that's just his personality coming across on screen, that he was so likeable and so lovable. But underneath it all, and I think from what I gathered from talking to Michael today, there was an honesty about it. He wasn't just saying these things. He was honest about his opinions. Yeah, exactly.
There is something about those players that came to England in the mid-90s. Like when the Premier League was being elevated to another level. And I know that there was like a spate of them after the World Cup in America, say, you know, and you had Klinsmann around that time. Or, you know, Radicchio and, you know, Dumitrescu and stuff.
Three final rules, wasn't it? That changed.
Well, that was sort of in the mid 90s. Well, that was around European games as well. But then, Viale was possibly like a really big name when he arrived. And that was when you were starting to get players in their pomp rather
just
than.
To the European Cup.
The Premier League was a little bit of a.
It was a Bosman as well, Dan, wasn't it?
But there was a retirement home vibe to some of the moves that they got, or a little bit sort of a, you know, a bargain basement element, or like it was still out of date.
Wasn't the destination.
No, but this was part of the transition, and like Viale and Hullett at Chelsea was I know Holland was obviously getting on at that stage, but still, it was. Then you're moving towards Zola and
Henri. Then
you're getting to that other level.
SAE came then, didn't he? Like, and exactly.
They were trailblazers in a certain way.
Golazzo was a game changer, wasn't it?
Yeah, like, and I don't know. Like, I obviously didn't know Gianluca Vialli, but you feel like reading the tributes that you can just almost relate to him, JD. That, you know, I have a great fondness for Italians in general, and he just comes across in from all the sort of tributes as this guy that would just light up the room with his smile and just a beautiful kind of humble man. I thought he had some great lines. You know, there'll be an awful lot of people today who will know of somebody who passed away from pancreatic cancer. It's you know, Pat Smullen, I suppose, would have been the one that's most recent in the sense of somebody I knew, and it's an awful disease because it's one of the worst forms of cancer you can get, and I think he had three battles with it and fought it twice, but he was quite philosophical about it in the sense that he said, this isn't a battle for me because, you know, cancer is much greater than me, but I'm not going to let it, you know, ruin what's left of my life, and I want to live as long as I can. Hopefully it gets bored and just runs away, and sadly it didn't. But the philosophy of you know, his kids, he said, kids learn from your actions rather than your words. And I think he's two girls, and they must be so bereft of losing a man like that. Imagine having a father like that. And I think for me, I'd be very nostalgic, like Graham mentions there, watching football from Italy as a kid. I mean, we're now accustomed to basically being able to watch any game we want, really, in the Premier League. And at that time, I don't even know, had we may have only had two channels. And when it was on Monday night, the highlights on, was it Miles Duggan used to present it? And I picked two teams, and Sampdoria were one of them, and Juve were the other. And just reading today how he and Mancini, like, they were such good friends in the playing days. And he didn't really want to move to Milan sort of straight away, because he felt like at a bigger club he wouldn't be, I suppose, as respected. And Sampdoria's only league win was when they were there. And do you know, it's kind of sad as well that the Premier League has gotten so big, and we talk about it here every Saturday. Other leagues have suffered, and Italy has suffered massively since those heady days, where I've been to games in Italy over the years, and you can feel the decline, you can feel the lack of money that's there. And a part of me would be nostalgic for that time when, you know, the Italian league was the best, and you had that great Milan team. But I think he belongs to another era. That story of, like, his first game where he at Chelsea, where he basically has all the players drinking champagne and they go on to win a second leg and overturn first leg deficit, it's very sad. And like, I think Dan touched on a good point there. You know, he wasn't that much older than me, and you do start to think about your own life and getting that bit older when somebody, when I heard he died, it just seemed a bit of a shock, even though he'd been so sick, because, like, Gianluca Vialli seems like somebody who's still, for me, putting on that jersey at Chelsea, or still, for me, is playing in the game in Italy. And you know, it's I didn't know the man from Adam, but it's sad. It's really sad to see somebody of that age. And the last thing I'd say about it is the way that he dealt with it, where he said, you know, I'm on a journey, I'll be on this journey until I pass away, but I'm going to enjoy what's left of my life and be a good example. And another lovely thing he said was, people, you know, they like you to smile, and they like you to laugh more than they like you to talk at times. And he just seemed like a beautiful man.
Yeah, well said, Johnny. We had a texter in here from Kevin Andrahada. Saw Gianluca play for Italy against Denmark. Euro 88 scored in that tournament, and always held a great place in my footy heroes, along with Franco Baresi. So you could always rely on him to get a goal. So well said, Kevin, as well, on 5-3-1-6 about Gianluca Vialli. It is FA Cup third round weekend, and Irish players in action. We're watching one at the moment.
Yeah, watching. Well, CJ Hamilton's also involved with Blackpool, he's been involved. But Andy Lyons is probably the story today, or probably a story that would generate a fair bit of discussion, because he's just completed his move. Obviously, the move was done ages ago, but he wasn't eligible to play for Blackpool after his move from Shamrock Rovers until January the 1st. So at the first available window, they've got him in. And I think there was an unavailability of another player that's facilitated it, but it's a great way for him to sort of get his feet in the door, you know, to establish himself and get a taste of football in England and playing against a Premier League club. I mean, it's a special day for him. I know for you, John, his uncle Johnny, yours would be
my best pal.
Be incredibly proud. And like, Andy's story is a sort of he's 22. He would have been at Bowes, probably synonymous with Bowes to a point, you know, after sort of a breaking through there and a couple of years there. But it was this time last year when I think, you know, nothing was really coming up for him in the UK. And I think he was looking at a few options and there was various agents involved. And for whatever reason, he ended up going to Shamrock Rovers instead. But he brought his game to another level there. As a left wing back, I'm actually quite interested trying to watch the game here to figure out, is he right back or right wing back just in this match? He would have been known as a right-sided player all of his life, even Ireland under-21s. But at Shamrock Rovers, he was a left wing back and he sort of thrived.
On that, Dan, I remember saying to you that I didn't think Andy Lyons was offered enough kind of
Blackpool
to taking the lead, I think.
A 1-0 against Nottingham Forest.
That when Andy Lyons at Bowes, I said, I don't think he offers enough, like, in attacking positions at times. And then he basically scores loads of goals as a left wing back for Rovers. And I think Stephen Bradley deserves a bit of credit because I could not see that coming, I have to say.
Well, to me, the attacking stuff was there. It was sometimes his defending in a back four.
Oh, his defending was outstanding.
Oh, no, I thought,
it was more questionable.
That would have been the question mark about him. His defence in a back four, right back. I remember watching him play an incredible game, the Bowes Derry game. It was 3-3. I remember that where Georgie Kelly scored. Andy Lyons was taken off for 20 minutes to go. He was really struggling. Like, you know, I think defensively in a back four would have been the question mark, but attacking wise, I thought
the game against when he was coming up for Bowes against proper opposition, he was absolutely outstanding that night. And I was like, this fella definitely could play at higher level. Never saw him making a left wing back though. He seemed to be quite right footed as well.
On the right today.
And then they put Neil Ferrugia right wing back, which was kind of almost thrown the rule book out the window. A very left footed player on the right, and Andy Lyons quite a right footed player.
It's hard to guarantee your crosses. It was one of the things that when they check back, it's very hard to stop a cross being coming into the box when you check back, and it gives them a chance to do that. But then they obviously, this suits the way Rovers play, and that they look for runners then to go into that space that the wing backs aren't going into by going on the outside. But I interviewed him just before he left on one of the clear the head things that we've done, and he spoke about yourself, he spoke about Johnny Lyons and his dad's his dad was big into Argentina. Johnny was big into
Mars, hope you're listening.
Johnny was big into Holland, and he had this big clash over
the 78 World Cup final.
Yeah, 78 World Cup final, because they went travelling, and it was interesting. And then he said Mount Merion, for example, where
Morris was involved. Yeah,
yeah, where White and where the Argentina kit, because Morris was involved, loved the Argentina kit. So I didn't know any of this. So stuff like that was really interesting, and how he lived, and when he went to Blackrock College, then he stayed in Diggs and used to travel. So he was well used to being away. He seems. When I speak to him, and I spoke to him quite a bit last season, he's very mature in his approach towards the game, and he knows that he constantly just has to get better, and he knows that there's elements of the game he needs to work on. He eats right, he doesn't touch alcohol at all, because he thinks I can't afford to make a wrong step here. I have to be at my maximum all the time.
That's all you can do, isn't it?
I want to. Yeah, and that's all you can ask for young players, like that, they have that thought process.
Yeah, FA Cup third round. Blackpool have taken the lead against Nottingham Forest 1-0. Bournemouth 0, Accrington 1. Bournemouth 1, Burnley 1. It's Chesterfield 1, West Brom 2. Fleetwood 0, QPR 0. Hull 0, Fulham 0. Ipswich 0, Rotherham 0. Middlesbrough 1, Brighton 1. Millwall 0, Sheffield United 0. And Shrewsbury 0, Sunderland 0. And earlier, Spurs beat Portsmouth 1-0. Southampton 1-2-1 at Crystal Palace. Forest Green and Birmingham was postponed. Gillingham 0, Leicester 1 a result. Preston 3. Huddersfield 1 a result, Reading 2, Watford 0 a result. Also just going to give you some scores from the Gaelic Games World with O'Byrne Cup matches and club matches on today. So the O'Byrne Cup, we have Westmeath 1-12, Wexford 4 points, second half score. Louth 12 points, Kildare 7, Meath 2-9, Laois 10 points, Longford 11 points, Carlow 3 and Offaly 1-8, Wicklow 5. In the Walsh Cup hurling, Dublin 2-18, Antrim 2-17 and Fossa of Kerry Lee Castletown 3-12 to 9 points in the Junior Football Club semi-final. The other semi-final saw Clifton lead Stewartstown last time we heard 1-7-9. And that's what's going on GA-wise. In terms of Irish footballers in the UK, I suppose the big story this week, lads, is Evan Ferguson.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's funny. I was presenting here last week, JD, and we had Simon Cox on and Dan and... I don't know, was it a... There was a little bit of... I don't know, what would you say when we talked about Ireland? It was, the mood was probably more half empty than... The glass is probably more half empty than half full. And there was kind of a reflection on the fact that, you know, we've a very tough kind of schedule ahead, and It seems as though Evan Ferguson's week has almost like just given a massive lift, and it's fascinating because, I mean, I spoke to Jim Crawford about him today, and he said not only was he, did we absolutely love him with the 21s when he came in, but apparently with the senior team he trained very well. But there was a brilliant piece in the Irish Independent today. I'd strongly recommend it, because they really went back into people that knew him. And the line that struck out for me, for, I think it was Keith Long who said it, was Evan would play football every day if he could. Would play football literally every minute of the day if he could. And he just seems so single-minded about what he has to do, because we can mention a million players that could have been what they didn't become because they were distracted by other things. Obviously, you know, the example of Aaron Connolly's we mentioned a lot, and Aaron Connolly's trying to reinvent his career, but I think Aaron took his eye off the ball big time. And what was interesting for me was that Evan Ferguson was so strong physically at an early age. Was he going to plateau? But for me, that goal against Arsenal was like, for a player of 18 years of age to show that strength,
Saliba, yeah,
was a bigger goal than the one against Everton. I think Everton were a bit of a shambles, but you can't but be really, really excited. And by March, does he emerge as like a really strong candidate for start for Ireland? Maybe he does.
Should we have players that are playing in the Premier League like Evan and Nathan Collins, as he will be in Arsenal and Bazunu, and say Joe Hodge, for example, should they be near the top billing because they're in the Premier League?
Well, I don't know. I think like there comes a point where an international team has to have some kind of structure and consistency, and if you just pick players on the basis of, you know, oh, he's doing it in the Premier League, you have to pick him. I mean, that's often what the fan shout will be. And I mean, I understand it
completely. It was with Darren Connolly back in the day.
Like, you know, I completely understand where it comes from. And sometimes it's right, you know. And but, like, the thing is, though, in fairness, like, Stephen Kenny brought Evan Ferguson into the squad in November. Now, interestingly enough, like, I think it was good to get that out of the way, so there's no sense of he's not coming in to meet the staff or something for the first time in March. I think that was a clever thing to do. But Kenny at the time was probably speaking about thinking possibly Ferguson could go out on loan in January, and by the time March comes around he could have suddenly played 15, 20 games, and you want to have him in. And I think it's something about Stephen Kenny. He doesn't always involve people in their first squad. He sort of brings them in to have them around the place, and then maybe they play in their second or third visit. But now with Ferguson, there's no fears. The one thing you would say about March is that Ireland have this friendly against Latvia, which is a little bit of a nothing game. And it's 5 days out from the France match. I think they wanted to have it as early as possible in the week because it's all about France. But actually, there could be interest in that game now if it is the case that this is when Evan Ferguson starts. And maybe that's his chance, that hopefully at that stage, you know, he still retained the momentum, because it is just 1 week.
Mm. Is there danger of overhyping?
Graham knows about Evan Ferguson. What I'd say on that is, of course there is, but like some of the stuff this week is a bit, it's like very predictable analysis. Like, well, be careful with Aaron Connolly, you know, and look what happened to Aaron Connolly with Evan Ferguson. When I think a lot of people involved in football here would know you're dealing with two quite different personalities. And
but say Troy Parrott, for example.
Yeah, but I think you're also dealing with a different type of personality there as well too. Like, for certainly like 18 months ago, I remember speaking to someone very much involved with football, and like you're so careful, you have to be so careful about how you speak about like 16, 17 year old players coming through. So you know, you don't want to shout from the rooftops, and also you can look silly, because of course, you know, Evan Ferguson, I'm sure in the last week, has possibly been exposed to things he's never, you know, offers, messages, like all the temptations and everything that will fall your way. I'm sure that's head scratching and head spinning, right? But like, people who know their stuff for a long time have been very confident about Evan Ferguson because of his attitude. And that hasn't necessarily been, there's always been that little bit of question mark over a couple of other players. That hasn't been there with him. And Graham will know more. He will know more about his dad and the background. And, I think Evan Ferguson has a sister that's over on a scholarship in America. Like, a very sporty family, like a great sort of environment. And people have always been convinced that whatever happens with Evan Ferguson, it won't be attitude that trips him up. Ability is obviously the question, but he's got loads of ability. So I'd be pretty optimistic that he won't go the way of maybe some of the more warning lessons. It's just injuries he has to avoid, I think, rather than that stuff. But Graham, you were being tormented by him when you were 12.
I obviously, when we started the academy for us, the Shamrock Rovers, we tried to get him out. Kevin's, I rang Barry a few times.
This is dad.
His dad, Barry, who I was lucky enough to play with at Longford. Barry was like, listen, the travel from Bettystown for him was too much. to go all the way across to the south side as well. And in fairness, it wasn't the right thing for Evan, and Barry knew that. As much as my personal relationship with Barry was strong enough, I live up beside Barry at the minute, so I see him quite often, and he says Evan's taken in his stride. He's hitting off, he's sort of where he needs to be at certain stages in his thing. But Barry was quite level-headed and quite relaxed about everything as a footballer as well. You go out to perform, and are you ready to perform? And he's instilled that in Evan. And like I said to you, we turned up to play a 12s game, and I had seen Evan, previously, and again, very physical, and he just absolutely battered us on the day. His game intelligence was really high. He was coming and collecting, setting, rolling, getting in the box. I think he scored two against us. We lost 4-0 in the final to win the league under 12, and he was excellent. And I just thought, I didn't realise he was as good as that in terms of his game intelligence, because obviously a kid at 12 can rely very much on the physicality, but he was excellent. And having spoke to Barry a lot about him since, and even like he got called into the first team squad, and he didn't tell Barry till later on that evening, and he was like, "Oh, I was busy," like, and
yeah.
Barry was saying, "What were you busy doing?" Like, "Oh, I just had a meeting in the bank," like, and Barry was laughing, going, "Like, how long did that take?" But he didn't see it as I need to get on the phone straight away. It was just one of those things he took in his stride, and like you said, from a long way out, nobody ever questioned his attitude towards the game. Like Johnny said as well, he had a joy and a love for the game that he just wanted to play it. And Barry can keep them level-headed and understand that there's going to be more peaks and troughs in this, and ups and downs in his career. And Barry's able to negate that with him because he's been through it himself. Like,
I think as well, like, Graham has been involved in a really good Shamrock Rovers underage system, and you know the pitfalls. You tell me stories of, like, to be a very good player for another club, and his dad would be trying to move him on to Rovers, even though you're thinking, is that right for the player? And I think that there's a story from, regardless of what happens to Evan Ferguson going forward, JD, and hopefully he'll become, you think, like, he's 3 years more of growth or whatever it is. When he's 21, he should be hitting more closer to his physical prime or whatever. But if you look at the role that Barry and his mother, I don't know his mother's name, but
Sarah,
Barry and Sarah have obviously played a massive role in this. The amount of kids, Satanta, I'm not sure if Satanta had become heir at the time, but Satanta did a documentary on Home Farm a few years ago, and it was amazing to see the role, sometimes good, but often bad, that parents can play in terms of players' development and kids' development. And another great line from the piece today, where it's like, I think one of the boys from Kevin said, "Don't be coming back now with tattoos or any of that nonsense." And he says, "Nah, that's not me." Like, probably a kid of his age was probably odds on to be loading up the tattoos, and just not for him.
What is Johnny, you have any tattoos?
No tattoos.
No tattoos in this, sir.
No.
Would
no.
you have been the tattoos
Wouldn't
man
be accepted
if you were
some of his hometown?
Granny, no, never. My support network was different going.
I don't think there's anything wrong with tattoos.
Like, I grew when I was coming out of Jobstown to go away, for example, we had Noel Bourne, who had just been to Liverpool and had come home. And then Stephen Bradley was the next big thing. So all the expectation was on Stephen. So I sort of went a little bit under the radar. And then what happened was Robbie Keane and Mick McCarthy came to the school to launch the Tala Bowl, which was meant to be launched behind their school, where their school was in Jobstown. So they rolled out me and Stephen for the press launch. And Mick McCarthy obviously heard I was signing for Barnsley and turned around and came over and made onto the news. And it sort of elevated me a little bit then, but it was still Stephen going to Arsenal was the big thing. But my support network was really good. I had two older brothers, and then my older sister's married to a guy called Mark Moraney, who had gone to Millwall when he was younger, and he came out of Jobstown as well. So I had been through all of these stories and told, like, listen, this is trying how you conduct yourself and do your business, but it's still so different than when you're living it, because you're living on your own, you have your own money, you've no one to answer to, you come and go when you please in terms of what you're doing, you have to be at the club at a certain thing, but it's still just going from a family secure network to go and do your own thing straight away. And some people need checks and balances to mind their finances, because it can get a little bit like my first wage pack, I bought a Boss denim jacket, and my whole wage packet was gone. But I thought it was the business.
Still have it?
Yeah. I do, yeah. It doesn't fit, but it was like, I put it on there before Christmas, and my missus was like, "Why'd you even buy that? Like, it's not even that nice." I was devastated. Yeah. But it was like, my whole wage packet was gone for the week, and I'm like, what? Like, I had no one to go. listen. And then all of a sudden you get talking, and my sister would say to me, listen, you don't need to buy that in a month, but put your money away for it, and you learn to plan and do things like that. So you learn and grow as you go, but again, having that network around you to make sure that you don't go with the pitfalls. But I also, the thing with the Aaron Connolly one for me, and even going back to the Evan one, when you go in and play at a higher level, it shows up the stuff, things that you might need to work on. So Evan might need to work on certain things that he realises, well, that didn't work against experienced defenders. It didn't work against players that can match me physically. Aaron, I played against Aaron when he was 17. He absolutely tore us asunder down in Galway one day, scored a hat-trick against us, and he was brilliant. And his pace and his directness was scary. And then it was all about, can you improve your movement so you can enhance your pace? And when you get to a higher level where defenders can might stay with you pace-wise and they're clever, you need to start working on certain things that's going to keep you there. So it's all well getting there, but can you enhance your game that you can stay here and learn on the job and become better at what you're doing against better opposition, instead of thinking, no, I'm good here, I'm okay.
What can Evan improve on then?
No, but that's what I'm saying to you. Evan will know that when he comes up against certain... Like, if Evan comes up against the Van Dijk, like, how does he get space away from him? So he has to learn that as you go. I remember playing against... I thought it was a really aggressive centre-back, and I played against a player called Wayne Allison. I'm not sure if any of you remember him.
He's a journeyman striker. Yeah,
played for Tranmere. And I was 17 at the time, playing in the reserves. And he was playing, and he literally just put his hand out, held me chest like that, and waved at the goalkeeper and to kick it. And looked at me and went, you're not getting this. And went like that and waved. And the keeper clipped one out, and he took it on his chest and he set it. And then he got across into the box. And then he done it again. He went to the keeper, keep doing it. Too small. And I was 6 foot. I was aggressive, but I just didn't have to. I didn't understand how to get round.
How did you react emotionally to that?
Yeah, well, I got frustrated, and I wanted to be more aggressive with him. So then eventually, pushing me underneath it. Yeah, he's pushing me underneath it. He's rolling me. So he played on me, and then I'm going to go, I need to figure out how to come up against somebody that, yeah, he might be able to run me over the top, but physically he can dominate me from the get. So now I went to work with a coach called, say, even Aaron Callaghan, who helped me here at Longford. How do you get out in front of strikers that want to back in against you? So it wasn't that I couldn't do it. It just showed up that I hadn't learned it yet. So for me to play at a higher level, I need to learn how to do that. And you only learn that by getting found out against somebody who had 500 league games against me. So it's just that learning process that, right, I need to work on that because I can't do that. And if I can't do that, that's going to catch me out. So that's what players, they'll break through and they'll burst on, and Aaron Connolly burst on. Right, what can I work on to keep me there? Because my pace is great, but you know, I might need to work on my movement so that I'm a little bit. Or how can I collect in front without getting hit? Because I'm not 6 foot. So again, movement, learning, watching videos, studying, going out and then putting into practice against better players.
Aaron Connolly on the bench today for Hull, where he's until the end of the season now. They're playing Fulham in the FA Cup. It's goalless at the moment. Just going to take a break in a moment. Just before that, the interest in the battle between defenders and strikers, the Haaland-Godfrey thing was fascinating. If you saw that last week, that Godfrey got under his skin and Haaland reacted. And you're wondering, is it going to, you know, make Haaland, because you flew into a challenge, is it going to actually galvanise him to play better? Or do defenders then actually, in the opposite way to your experience then, because I'm sure you got on top of strikers then, almost shrink a striker?
Yeah, I can't see him shrinking. I can't. I just can't. I think, like you said, you look at him, we talk about Evan Ferguson's background. Look at his background, like, you know, with his dad having played and gone through what he went through at different clubs, and you'd imagine with even the coaches he has around him that are saying, listen, if they want to fight you like that, we'll work on something that when they go to step in front of you, you just run down the side of them. Or if they're trying to niggle you, we'll work on something else. But it's good to see him show a bit of emotion as well. I think I heard somebody called him a bit of a robot the other day, and I thought it was a little bit unfair. They described him as being too robotic, and I think it was actually good to see the fact that he is going to show a bit of
aggression. It was quite a funny little video about it.
Because I think the Norwegians and the Scandinavians get told they're not very emotional, they're a little bit cold, a little bit too robotic, they're a little bit too structured, and I actually thought, well, fair play to them for showing a little bit more.
Graham Gartland, Dan McDonnell and Johnny Ward on Football Saturday. You want to text us on anything on football, any question, any opinion, you can on 53106. We're back after this break. Don't go away.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Sky, watch every single live Premier League game this season on Sky Sports, BT Sport and Premier Sports.
This is News Talk.
Alive and Kicking with Claire McKenna.
This Sunday morning on Alive and Kicking, what's the story with all the viruses this winter? And I meet the pharmacist who has a solution for the health crisis. I'll also be joined by transformation specialist Dr. Yolanda Coombs on what it really takes to make change this year.
Alive and Kicking
with Benelin.
Alive and Kicking with me, Claire McKenna, this Sunday morning at 8.
On News Talk.
There's never been a better time to go full Lidl. Let's hear it from our customers.
I'd say you don't know what you're missing until you do it, and you really will see the choice, the selection, the value for money. You know, you don't know until you try, so it's priority, get down to Lidl and get your shop done.
Go on, go full Lidl today.
Are you at high risk from COVID-19? COVID-19 doesn't wait, and neither should you. If you are at high risk of severe COVID-19 and showing symptoms, it's time to act immediately. Assess yourself for symptoms, confirm through COVID-19 testing, and if positive, talk to your healthcare professional to seek clinical assessment and advice. Visit knowyourrisk.ie to find out if you are at high risk of severe COVID-19. This message is brought to you by Pfizer and supported by the Irish Heart Foundation.
I hear you some wiring needs a fixing, ma'am. The name's Buzz, on account of my work.
No chance.
Not all cowboys ride horses. Allsafe Electric registered electrical contractors must give you a certificate of completion that shows their work meets approved standards. Find one nearby on safeelectric.ie.
Air Gigabit Fibre Broadband is our best ever broadband, way better than cable. It's your own line straight to your home, so no more sharing with the neighbours.
Mrs. Murphy was on my internet. What is she saying?
Sign up today and get 1 month free. Plus, Virgin Media customers save up to €300 by switching to Air. Call 1-800-500-300-GO in store or visit air.ie. Offer ends 31st of January, subject to location and availability. 12-month contract. Setup fees may apply. T's and C's apply. See air.ie/save300.
Hotels. We often play host to so many of life's big events, whether they're a once-in-a-lifetime occasion or those few magical moments away each year. At FBD Hotels and Resorts, our teams are committed to making every visit memorable, whether it's a drink with an old friend or making that perfect business pitch. Behind each memory is a team that cares. FBD Hotels and Resorts. It's just our way.
Taking time out to visit a healthcare professional isn't always convenient. That's why at Irish Life Health, we visit you. With My Clinic, our members get virtual access to back and neck physiotherapy, professional counselling, unlimited GP consultations and more. Search Irish Life Health. A better life with Irish Life Health. Services available where covered in your plan and clinically appropriate. Professional counselling available to age 16 plus. Back and neck physio to age 18 plus. Irish Life Health DAC is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland. Terms and conditions apply.
Leinster v Racing 92 in the Heineken Champions Cup. Saturday, January 21st at 3:15 in the Aviva Stadium. See Europe's biggest stars in action. Tickets on sale now at leinsterrugby.ie. Terms and conditions apply.
Galvin Tullamore Sale now on. Ireland's destination menswear store. Galvin Sale now on.
At Bow Concept, we believe you deserve the best in timeless contemporary Danish design. And now it's more affordable than ever, with extraordinary savings across our furniture collection. Allow our in-store designers to tailor our Scandinavian design classics to your space. In-store at Beacon South Quarter and Arnott's Henry Street. Bow Concept sale now on.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Sky. Watch every single live Premier League game this season on Sky Sports, BT Sport and Premier Sports.
This is News Talk.
And welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. John Duggan with you through to 5. Football Saturday, the first of the new year with Graham Gartland, Johnny Ward and Dan McDonnell of the Irish Independent in studio. Remember, Football on Off the Ball brought to you by Sky. The Premier League is back. Watch every live game for the rest of the season on Sky Sports, BT Sport and Premier Sports. You can text us 53106. Listen across the country on News Talk and your radio, and also watch us if you like on the digital and social channels on Twitter, Facebook, YouTube and on the OTB Sports app. So the FA Cup third round is ongoing. Matches that kicked off at 3:10 of them. Blackpool, we mentioned Andy Lyons in that team today, 1-0 lead against Nottingham Forest. Bournemouth 0, Accrington 1. It is Bournemouth 1, Burnley 2. Chesterfield 2, West Brom 2. Fleetwood 0, QPR 1. Hull 0, Fulham 1. Ipswich 0, Rotherham 0. Middlesbrough 1, Brighton 2.
Millwall 0, Sheffield United 2, Shrewsbury 0, Sunderland 0. You were watching Man United beat Everton last night, Graham Gartland. Rashford, is it all about confidence? He is right back to his best.
Yeah, he looked electric last night. I think even for the, was it the second goal he set up, he looked unbelievable. He's so direct at the moment, yeah. Isn't he? Where he just picks it up and he's looking for quickest route to goal. And it's scary. When he's running downhill, it's a scary prospect to be facing. I thought he looked good last night at times. You know, it became a little bit of a basketball match at times where Everton had chances. When it went to 2-1, there was one across the box. I think Man United cleared it off the line. But it looked like both teams looked dangerous on the counter attack. But Rashford looks, yeah. I think it's a better environment for him to play. And he knows where everybody knows where they stand. They know that if you're not on the ball, you're not going to play. So it's about, are you ready to perform to play? And if they're not, they don't play. And I think players react to that because they know if I'm doing my job and I'm doing everything right and I'm performing, I'm going to play. And if there's no favourites, there's no favouritism, there's no, you know, looking to play bigger names just because they're in the club. I think he's done a really good job at resetting the standards there at Manchester United, and I think you see the likes of Rashford will flourish in that. I think young players do flourish in that because they need them sort of boundaries.
The discipline.
Yeah.
The Wolves thing was interesting because he benched him because he was late or whatever the reason was, and then he came on and he scored.
Came on and he scores, and then he goes and performs last night. So he obviously accepts that, do you know what, I was in the wrong, but I'll make it up to you. He's reacting to it in a positive way. Where I think when the environment isn't good around you and that happens, you're nearly gone. But what about what he done and what about what they done? And they didn't get punished, but I did.
Well, he won the battle there. He won the battle with Ronaldo. That was the big thing.
Ten Hag just seems to be playing a blinder. Like
in 10 wins and 11 now.
And just as the handling of that situation in the Wolves game, I mean, just it worked out perfectly. The handling of the Ronaldo situation, he's gone now. That worked out perfectly. And as you mentioned, they're on unbelievable form.
You can coach as well. You can see it in the structure of the team. Casemiro obviously has been
Casemiro's been massive, in terms of, and even like the likes of Maguire, like not playing Maguire and putting Shaw in centre back, who obviously Martinez coming back in the World Cup might come back in. I think he's realised that I think Maguire is a decent defender, but I think he struggles to be a unit defender. I wouldn't like to play beside him. I think he defends for himself. And I get the examples of that would be crosses. So if he's the left-sided centre-back and I'm the right-sided centre-back and we're defending a cross from the right-hand side, he will latch onto his man and leave that space for you at the front post, and that kills you.
Was he at fault for that cross the World Cup?
Yeah. See, when I see him latch onto people like that and vacate that front post area, it leaves the second. You're nearly on an island as the second centre back defending that cross, and that's the bit where I'm going, yeah, I understand that's your man. You want them scoring, but you need to take your position off the ball. And if you take your position off the ball, me as the next centre back, I take my position off you on the inside of you. If you vacate that area and step out, I'm left on my own, and then what I have to do is cover that space, the front post area, a little bit more, take me out of the centre of the goal, and I have to pull my other either second centre back, third centre back in if you're playing three centre backs, and me full back in, and that gives up the back post area. So he unsettles teams in terms of, because he just thinks that's my man, I'm stopping him scoring. And there's a lot to be said for that as well at certain times, but you have to do it as a centre back pair. And I think sometimes he can leave his other centre back on their own and a little bit isolated, and especially from crosses into the box. And I think Ten Hag has recognised that and gone with, you know what, we're going to go with a better partnership rather than just, well, it's on paper that you're a better defender.
It'd be interesting to see, Dan, how the players that played at the World Cup do now in the next while. Martinez, we mentioned there, Alvarez coming back into the City situation.
Yeah, I suppose. I mean, you see the Brighton reaction to Alexis McAllister this week and Messi's return to PSG. There's obviously, you know, there's the contrast between the players who are coming back on the high and then those are on a different mood. I mean, you see Harry Kane is sort of back at it now, despite sort of having suffered something that he said, you know, he'll struggle to get over it. So I think there's probably two stages to that World Cup reaction. There's the emotional, which is now, but then I think there's probably going to be the physical, which is later in the season. And I think when you get to March, April, May time, I know different players play different amount of games, you know, I think someone like Mbappe or something, you know, and the demands, if PSG go on into the latter stages of the Champions League, which obviously isn't a given, some of those players it might catch up with them maybe later in the season, but it's very hard. I think it's very individual, you know. I'm not sure if we're going to see some collective trend that we can draw some conclusions from. And I mean, to be fair, like, you know, clubs now have all the access to the sports science and everything that should be able to warn them, you know, if players are sort of in a danger zone in terms of how they've pushed themselves. But I think you've seen it. Like, there's been, it's been reasonably sensible how clubs have been sort of reintegrating players. It's probably a bit of a managerial challenge. Like, how much time is enough? Like, if you, especially if you know a player's celebrating, and it's like, well, you obviously don't want to like take something
if
away.
If I wanted lads, I wouldn't have seen that.
Yeah, you want to take something. You don't want to take something away from like, you know, the special memory of someone's life.
But how do you measure mental fatigue? Like, see, when you have your physical KPIs that you might go right, that they're, you know, they need rest, they're going to pull a hamstring, they're going to pull muscles, because...
Are Liverpool suffering from that at the moment?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That, how do you measure mental fatigue? Like, because, they're, like you said, you're going to get to March and they're going to go, this feels like the longest season in the world, because we fit a World Cup in between this. That's never happened before. So it's something that these players, and nobody ever in the history of the game has gone through that, because nobody, we've never had a World Cup at that time of the year. So it, you can't even go to somebody, how did you get through this? Because there's no one to relate it to. So it's a complete anomaly. Like, so how do you measure mental fatigue on players? Because it is going to see, like, we're already sitting here going, feels like a long season, and we're only back in January, like, because the World Cup's been there.
Well, I suppose it's I mean, to bring everything back home in a sense, like, you've got sort of France coming to Dublin in March, and you think of, like, a lot of those French players are at high end clubs, so they're in the midst of, like, a, you know, they've had this incredible sort of adventure, or sort of draining adventure, you know, in November, December, where some of them were sick as well, and there was all sorts of elements to it. You know, they go back to their clubs where a lot of them are competing for leagues and trophies, so they'll be expected to be right at it, and then they come to the end of the March and all of a sudden there's an international window thrown in there where they play Holland and then they come to Dublin, and it's like, something will give at some stage, you know. And maybe that's the really, that's the glass half full take from the Irish perspective.
Is there still a winter break in the, like, Germany and Spain and all these countries?
Oh, the top, no, not. I've been looking at results, and there was definitely matches in Spain and Germany in the last week or so.
I think they've changed it this year, but in general, like, they have some sort of, there is some sort of break that does exist. I mean, like, the Premier League was very adamant about getting back because of the sanctity of the Stevens Day games. So they wanted to be straight back. I mean, they had the Carabao Cup, didn't they? Like, 2 or 3 days. I know, like, there was games in France, like, Mbappe was straight back at him, but then he's probably, he's 23. He's in the, he went to New York then, but he was, like, you know, it, again, like, it's a man management thing as well too,
to have that,
like,
life, to have that life.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Days, yeah, that's... yeah. I mean, I'm trying to imagine how you would celebrate it, John. You know,
yeah. I just,
Johnny would be gone. Johnny be off.
I just remember, I was watching the flight coming into Buenos Aires. I was going, how amazing is this?
But I think that's the thing for, like, Martin is, like, think of, like, you know, he's the goalkeeper. He's been in the centre of it. He's been, like, stirring everyone up. Like, and then he's
villain of the world.
He goes back, and then he goes back to, like, you just go back to, like, club football, to Villa, and it's like, I'm in Solihull. You know, like, you know, like, you know, like, life just suddenly can just sort of...
Sorry, Solihull.
Yeah, no offence. Like, but you know what I mean? There is that sense of... God, it's like someone who goes on a great holiday and they're still talking about their holiday.
It's like me on January.
You know, people going on their J1 and still talking about it, like, for, you know, 4 months later. You know, there is that sense of, like, you know, there's
I lived in Sydney for 2 years when back in 2004. You're like, all right, yeah.
Exactly. There's a bit of that with Graham's not talking about himself personally, no, to be clear. He was winning cups then, but with Barry Ferguson. But no, like, there is that sense of, like, different players will react. You see, like, McAllister's speculation around his future and stuff, and it's like, do you suddenly think? I mean, the mad one, of course, is Enzo Fernandez, who could. They say that the World Cup doesn't really add, you know, value to a player like it used to back in the day, yet he could actually become the most expensive player in the world.
Rodriguez syndrome, wasn't it? Because after he'd done well for Colombia, then Real Madrid bought him, and that there was that.
Never reached those heights again, did he?
Oh, and then they were saying, like, that, you know, be careful because of Rodriguez, look what happens. But I think when you...
It's a runaway train, though, the game, that's the problem, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. And I think there's more research goes into the fact that they look at what he's done and the distance he's covered as a midfielder, and Benfica have a track record now. Benfica are number one selling team in Europe. Like, they've made the most money from their transfers in the last 2 years.
Speaking of holidays as well, Judy, a lot of people would have considered Dan's time in the Middle East as a sort of a, I don't know, like a working holiday, and you've had a little bit of time off since. I should have mentioned it was Aidan Fitzmaurice who did the piece on Evan Ferguson, but it's well worth the read. Personally, I wouldn't have considered it a a working holiday.
I didn't consider it a working holiday at all.
Yeah, it's some people would be like, you're watching football, you're getting paid to watch it.
It's a privilege.
One of the hardest things you can do in this, and it's a very privileged business, is go to a major event.
Like especially when there are like two or three games a day or whatever, and you can go to two games a day.
Was it mentally or physically? Was it mentally tough?
Well, it's just like...
When do you know if the mental fatigue, you don't really know?
Yeah, I don't know, yeah. You're the ones that brought it up. I'm the one that... I've already moved on to the next challenge. Okay. No, like, I mean, 18 games in 13 days. I mean, it's a privilege, but I mean, it's a bit intense. But honestly, this never plays well if you start talking about it being hard.
What about it?
You just sound like a prat, really. Yeah. So you have to accept that.
This has been a proper cup tie, JD. Blackpool and
is the
Forest.
Magic back in the FA?
Some really old school.
Yeah. And have this debate every year.
Just to bring this back to Ireland, I think the FAI Cup kind of started to decline as the FA Cup declined, but I think the FAI Cup has brought on way more magic in recent years because of the Aviva Stadium, and I think the FAI Cup is as good as ever these days.
I love the FAI Cup.
Maybe some of the earlier rounds, the non-league teams have to do better and whatever, you can look at that, but I think that it's in a great position. The FA Cup, I don't know, I mean, probably not, to be honest.
We can't have our annual January.
Oh, we can't have that debate every year. Oh, but it's not like it was in the 80s when there was.
This has been a cracking tie.
We have to accept it for what it is now.
The underdogs in front, I mean, I presume like Blackman wouldn't be a massive prize, but the referees let some really, really kind of aggressive challenges go. It's January. It's a proper cup tie. And I do hope for Andy Lyons that this would be I do hope for Andy Lyons that, if he were to win this game, it'd just be a great little start and give him that bit of confidence. And he's done fine anyway, what I've watched of the game so far on the right.
They've got replays in the third and fourth rounds. I think it's to help the lesser clubs, get a bit of a payday. But no replays from the fifth round onwards in the FA Cup. They're talking about scrapping them completely. Listeners out there, are you still invested in the FA Cup or is it just a blur now? Given how big it was as a competition in a few decades ago, 53106. I love the show. Astonishing. We've got a football show totally dedicated to another nation's league, and we've no short paper dedicated to our own. Obviously, I know the reasons why, but still baffling. After many decades, we still can't grow the game here, says one of our texters. Maybe one day. And then another, looking forward to a great year in sports. Hopefully, you'll be able to attend the Ireland matches for the Women's World Cup, although probably a problem with these tickets, says Dermot on 53106.
You do mention, though, just briefly, JD, the Argentina team coming off the plane. All that, the boost Ireland just doing reasonably well and winning a few games and doing well against France and the Netherlands would be massive.
As much as we love Gaelic games, it doesn't have a market outside this country.
And forget about rugby in terms of what it means to every corner of Ireland. It doesn't. This is the sport for the Irish national team that really, Italian 90 will never be topped. And this, just even for Ireland if Ireland were to beat France or, at least get a one-all draw or, create some magic for us, I think would mean so much.
My auntie last year, she left a picture for all of us in the house. She got a couple of prints up, and it was me standing on a stepladder holding me younger brother,
trying to get over the forward, probably
my younger brother behind me, my other brother standing beside me, sister and my uncle and my dad standing in the picture. My dad had a full 88 Celtic tracksuit on. And we were all in town waiting to see Ireland come home from World Cup 90. My auntie Aileen got us a picture, all of us as a family there together, just waiting. And even that moment of going in to see them, just stays with you. And I know, listen, not comparing that to Buenos Aires with 50 million.
But it was our Buenos Aires.
It was 1 million. It was one third of our population at the time going out to cheer Ireland for getting to a quarter final of a World Cup. And it was just, like you said, it captured the nation. And
it's so important that the women's team hopefully can do well in the summer. 53106, you want to get in touch, lads. The FA Cup is like discovering it's an international break and no Premier League football. Devastating, says Niall, one of our texters.
It's harsh, isn't it?
A little bit harsh. Half-time scores, Blackpool 1, Nottingham Forest 0, Boreham Wood 0, Accrington 1, Bournemouth 1, Burnley 3, Chesterfield 3, West Brom 2. It's Fleetwood 1, QPR 1, Hull 0, Fulham 1, Ipswich 1, Rotherham 0, Middlesbrough 1, Brighton 2, Millwall 0, Sheffield United 2, and Shrewsbury 0, Sunderland 0. We've got Graham Gartland Gartland, Dan McDonnell and Johnny Ward in studio on Football Saturday. You can text us or ask a question to the lads on anything you want in terms of the world of football on 53106. Back after the news, in just before we go there, let's just go through some Gaelic games results in the Walsh Cup. Latest score into the closing stages: Dublin 326 for Dublin, Antrim 222. So Micheál Donoghue will get off the mark with a win. In the O'Byrne Cup full times, Westmeath 116 Wexford 6 points, Louth 14 points, Kildare 110, a result win for Louth. Meath beat Laois. No, they didn't. It was a draw, actually. 2-10 for Meath. Laois 16 points. 16 points apiece of full-time in Navan. Longford defeated Carlow 15 points to 4. And Offaly 1-9. Wicklow 7 points is a result. And Fossa have beaten Castletown in the junior football semis 3-14 to 11. Stewartstown 1-14. Clifton 1-9, a result in the other junior football semi. In the intermediate semis, Galbally Pearce is 4-4. Dunmore Mycales 1-9 and Rathmore beat Feathered by 216 to 110. We're back after the news. Don't go away, folks. Thank you.
Listen to News Talk on Smart Speaker. Play News Talk.
Galvin Tullamore sale now on. Ireland's destination menswear store. Galvin sale now on.
Emergency services?
Hi.
What service do you require?
Who are you talking to?
Ma'am, how are you?
Get back here!
Fine. No, these restrictions aren't easy.
I said, who are you?
Yes.
We're sending help now.
Call yourself a man or lock the door.
If your home isn't safe, support is still here. Go to stillhere.ie for a list of supports, an initiative of the Government of Ireland with frontline services in your community.
Hi, I'm Ken Doherty, and when I need car insurance, I contact the specialists at insuremycars.ie. Their team always finds me the best policy at the lowest price and with all the benefits I need. If your car insurance is up for renewal, visit
insuremycars.ie. City Financial Marketing Group Limited, trading as insuremycars.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
If you're about to use an electrical appliance, like your hairdryer, which uses a lot of energy, just ask the question, is this a good time?
Yeah, electricity demand's fairly low. You're looking good.
If it's before 5 p.m. or after 7 p.m, it is a good time because it's outside of peak hours when less of us are using electricity at the same time. To find out the best times for your electricity usage, sign up to our pilot at esbnetworks.ie/pilot.
Hello?
This is your call to make a real difference. Aware are here for people living with depression and bipolar disorder. Now more than ever, we need your help for our phone and online support teams. You can change someone's world from your own home. Volunteer now at aware.ie, proudly supported by Cadbury Dairy Milk.
A new year, a new chance to treat yourself and get away from it all with Go Breaks. Choose from hundreds of incredible hotel deals at gobreaks.ie.
Go Breaks!
January sale at Currys. Save €480 on the 55-inch Samsung 4K OLED TV, now €1,799. Save €100 on the Bosch Series 2 electric oven, now €319. And get free delivery on large kitchen appliances and large screen TVs. Get in-store or online at currys.ie. T's and C's apply. See website for details.
This year, Skodas all over the country will take thousands of new babies home from the hospital. Brides-to-be to their weddings. Camogie champions on a lap of victory around their local village. Excited new family dogs home from the rescue centre. Proud parents to their firstborn's graduation. There's so much to look forward to. Here's to brighter days ahead. Skoda, made for Ireland.
Leinster v Racing 92 in the Heineken Champions Cup. Saturday, January 21st at 3:15 in the Aviva Stadium. See Europe's biggest stars in action. Tickets on sale now at leinsterrugby.ie. Terms and conditions apply.
We're on Twitter. Just look for @NewsTalkFM for the latest updates.
On 106 to 108 FM, on the News Talk app,
powered by Go Loud
and Smart Speaker. This is News Talk.
It's 4 o'clock. This is Ken Murray. Good afternoon. A former HSE chief is warning there are chronic issues facing the Irish healthcare system. With nurses now considering industrial action over staffing levels, there are fears the ongoing overcrowding crisis could get worse before it gets better. Tony O'Brien, the former director general of the HSE, says nurses have been running trolley checks for nearly two decades, and there's never been a time when there were enough beds available.
Clearly, you can moderate the number of hospital beds you need by providing other types of services, and there has been movement in that direction. But the fundamental thing is there is not enough capacity. Like, we have waiting lists for home support, or home help as we used to call it. We have delays in getting people into nursing homes for a variety of reasons, and then we have people who simply need to be in hospital beds who in total exceed the number of hospital beds available.
The Irish Red Cross is welcoming the use of Croke Park for refugee accommodation. Up to 140 people fleeing the war in Ukraine are to be housed at the Dublin Stadium for 2 weeks from this weekend. The government released a statement earlier this week appealing to any Ukrainians currently in a place of safety not to travel to Ireland in the coming weeks due to a severe shortage of state accommodation. Liam O'Dwyer from the Irish Red Cross thinks it's an arrangement that could be replicated around the country.
The emergency response from the government so far has been really, really excellent, because they're managing to find accommodation and more accommodation of this nature. The larger accommodation is going to be required. And I think people have to see it, though, in terms of an emergency. This is not your normal response.
Britain's Prince Harry is being accused of metaphorically detonating a landmine under Buckingham Palace with his autobiography. He's also faced criticism from British military chiefs after revealing he killed 25 Taliban fighters in Afghanistan. US journalist Skylar Baker-Jordan claims Americans appear to have more sympathy for him.
They see a vulnerable young man who is being emotionally honest for perhaps the first time in his life, whereas the British tend to see a spoiled rich kid with every privilege that life can afford moaning about the gilded cage he found himself in.
And that's your news at 4:02.
News Talk weather.
Thanks to Ryanair. See your Premier League team this year with daily flights to Liverpool, Manchester and London.
Tonight will continue windy, particularly in the west and north. Clear spells and scattered showers, some heavy, with a further possibility of hail and thunder. Fresh to strong and gusty southwesterly winds with gales near west and northwest coasts. High seas persisting on western coasts, winds will ease somewhat overnight. Cold with lowest temperatures of 2 to 4 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Sky. Watch every single live Premier League game this season on Sky Sports, BT Sport and Premier Sports.
This is News Talk.
And you're welcome back to Off the Ball. Sandra here on News Talk. John Duggan with you 3 to 5. The first football Saturday of 2023. Remember, football on Off the Ball brought to you by Sky. Get all the football you love in one place across Sky Sports, BT Sport and Premier Sports. You can text us 53106. Tweet us at Off the Ball. Listen across the country on your radio and News Talk. Also watch us if you'd like on the digital and social channels if you're on the move. On Periscope, Twitter, at Off the Ball, YouTube, Facebook, and on the OTB Sports app. Joined in the studio by the League and FAI Cup winning footballer Graham Gartland, football correspondent of the Irish Independent Dan McDonnell, and the broadcaster and journalist Johnny Ward. FA Cup third round weekend, getting some texts in. Johnny was kind of talking about Italia 90 and probably the biggest thing that's ever happened in this country, and that's fair enough. Michael and Nermick's been in touch, 53106. Italia 90, you'll never be beaten. Now, Johnny, what a depressing statement. We didn't even win a game. Surely we need to be more ambitious than that.
I wouldn't mind us getting to the last 8 of a World Cup.
But it will never be beaten.
Totally embarrassing. It still gets a mention in 2023, says Michael.
No, but in terms of what it did for a nation, like, and I was only a kid, but I mean, Graham, I think, summed it up very well there. I think in terms of the country being completely coming out of the depression and recession of the 80s and having something that made the tricolour proud, you know, proud to be having again, and just the team getting to the, they got to the last 8, like, how far are we off that now, and we'd never even been there before.
Yeah, it'll never be top. I mean, there's nothing new to say in this point, and maybe again we're all of a similar enough age and we're lucky enough to remember it, and to anyone what under 35 or something, like, you know, Italia 90 is something they've heard stories about. But it's because it was the first time, and you can, of course, you can critically assess the sporting performance as you can of anything, you know, as you can of, like, people still talk about you know, Munster and the All Blacks and all these things like many years later. And you could maybe break it down and go, well, you know, what about this? Or what about that? Or what did that mean? But it was the moment that lives. And Italian 90 is the moment that anyone who remembers it lived through it. Like all those people came out in the streets because they were stirred into doing so. And like,
we didn't win a game in the football.
We're also far too cynical.
We performed better in the 2000 the 2002 World Cup.
We played the best. That was the best Irish team.
You don't get there without Italian 90. Italian 90 was the catalyst.
Italian 90 was the first national celebration since independence. I knew that was the thing.
Yeah, and also you don't get the Japan Korea experience from them set of players without them players as kids having gone through Italian 90.
Yeah.
So that's what it sparked it.
I don't think we've kicked on from that, and I still think we're a long way from realising the sort of potential, which was over 30 years ago. But in terms of facilities in this country and issues in the game here, there are still...
We've done it before. But what's happened is, yeah, we've done it before, but other nations have moved on and we're still trying to replicate, well, that's how we've done it before. And we'll get this inspiration out of the O2 World Cup. We'll get another generation of players out of that. But they need something to come into.
Yeah, didn't build anything.
Got a 5306 high. Can you ask your panel if they've heard anything about this proposed League of Ireland facilities audit that is supposed to happen?
I have been off work the last sort of couple of weeks, so I'm not sure. There was an FAI AGM where I think when I was away in Qatar that it took place. I think it was referenced that maybe it might be a little bit down the line before we hear of it. I mean, this is a really important thing. I mean, it almost ties in with what Johnny was saying, our general point. I mean, like, Italian 90 should have been the catalyst to build facilities around the country. But instead, we just lost our minds thinking, yeah, we can just keep, you know, throwing up sort of second or third second generation Irish players. And, you know, news pages were filled with stuff about, let's get Chris Armstrong or Vinnie Jones or whoever, what are we doing? What are we doing with, like... politically, like, what are we doing with the capital that the sport had gained up at that point, and there was no legacy really at all. The FAI have come in and talked about a facilities audit to completely audit the facilities. I mean, to me, a facility audit in some of the places wouldn't be too complicated. You walk in and you go, this is a dump, that's the end of the audit. You know, like, this, why we're giving this place a derogation every year, it's clearly not fit for purpose. But the problem is that it's getting the access to the funds to obviously turn these things around. And while people like me will go on about this, I do accept that, like, you know, to get access to maybe some of the large scale infrastructure funds, it can move slowly. And clearly, unfortunately, like, we're in a kind of cost of living crisis at the moment, and while I think investment in sport always pays off, you know, it's always like the return on investment is generally very good, particularly if it's like community facilities, you know, and it's accessible for sort of a lot of a wide range, I think it's always justifiable. It happens so slowly. Like, how long are we waiting for Finn Harps to happen, you know? And
that's a knock-on effect for the health crisis as well.
Well, I mean, that's what I was going to say. It's going to keep people out of hospitals.
It's a knock-on effect for the health crisis because if you keep kids in sport, and your previous guest touched on it before we came in, if you keep kids in sport and active all the way through, it lessens the health crisis further on down the road. So you're actually helping yourself financially as well.
But to answer the question, I think the can has been kicked down the road a small bit, but you're hoping to hear about it in due course.
But it probably has to be, Dan, like you said, because the finances aren't there. So what other choice do you have?
Well, the audit shouldn't be held up by finances. I think it's actually a report on where it's at. I think it's been moving along, but I'm not sure if it's quite...
I don't think the finances are there to fix it. They put in for a big grant to say, I think it ended up being something like 70% of the sports grant that the FAI were looking for.
Well, League of Ireland clubs face, like everyone, they face a problem. If you're trying to build a house now, imagine multiplying that by, you know, a million, because if you're trying to build anything to do with football stadium now, the prices are absolutely off the charts. So it's not, like, Dan is kind of right. It's easy to say, oh, like, why don't the authorities, but it's complex. It's not straightforward.
My anger would be historical rather than, say, the last year or two.
I made these comments back when I was playing, and like, I look back and think, Jesus, you know, I probably should have just left it. But I remember talking about, and it was around a little bit what we were doing, because we were going through a Drogheda. They were trying to build housing estates in Drogheda, and that was part of getting a new stadium for the club. And one of the things was, if they gave the owners this land, they could build loads of houses, but they were also going to build a stadium. And the council were going, no, there was a lot of red tape behind it and stuff. But that's where if I'm the government, I'd be saying to these investors that want to build housing estates, you need to build sports facilities that run in line with these housing estates. because if you haven't gone out, and where are you going to go? And also, you're moving to an area that has X amount, or has this stadium or has that stadium. You need to, there needs to be certain investment from the property developers to build up the area, that it's a good place to grow up for children to be in there and be able to participate in multiple sports, whether it's rugby, Gaelic, football, all these different sports. There has to be facilities for these. So if a housing company or a developer comes to the government and says, I want to buy this land because I want to put X amount of houses in it, there has to be a certain amount that they go, right, this needs to be for sport facilities for the future of the kids in this country. That would be my take tarnished it.
Teacher, even.
Who knows?
Yeah, he's just going for tarnish. He's aiming low.
I wouldn't
he's
like
more of a number two. Yeah. He's more of a, it's like you and Neil McCann again.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
Neil McCann is Taoiseach.
That name drop, yeah.
Yeah, you haven't dropped a name in at least 5 minutes.
I know.
To be fair.
It's been a while.
5316, lads, we need municipal stadia. Like your earlier commentator stated, medium sized towns should have good facilities, not three or four per facilities in rugby, soccer, Gaelic, and hockey. With one large facility, we could have a community gym.
I was laughing when Pele passed away. Way and you know this whole FIFA thing about you know name a stadium after Pele. People are throwing out all these like GAA venues. I'm like, lads, you wouldn't let football in the door before you're calling it Sem Pele Stadium. It's like the classic sort of the classic sort of Irish mindset thing. It's like FIFA wants us to know. Oh yeah, let's throw in a GAA venue into this. And I mean, maybe it's a little bit of a humorous take, but it's like, yeah, imagine the idea of you know football in some of these venues. You know, that'd be quite a thing, wouldn't it?
Sports then. Like build up the sports where you have Astros all around it. There's the stadium. So what happens is, and I go again, touching on my own experience here. One of the reasons I signed for Barnsley had an academy that was built around the stadium, was built under the back stand. So I used to go in every morning, go into the same stadium, see all the same people, go out and train. But when it was match day, all them same people were there. I was very comfortable. So when they said to me, you're going to go out and play on the first team pitch, it wasn't this big daunting thing to me, because I was like, I'm around this every day. I run around the track in the mornings. I go over and do my education over there. That thing of my aim is to get there, but it's not something that's unattainable for me. I can do it. If you're building like Astros beside the stadiums, gym facilities, all these things that people can go and participate in, and then they go eventually to get a chance to go
clubs
and play
need
the
to become more club, like, clubs need to be more than pitches and seats as well. You know, you can become a community hub. You can have a bar there that's open like every night. You can have like various facilities, coffee shop, stuff like that.
Yeah,
that's the future. But like I honestly do despair at this country. Like when we've a half decent and it's half decent stadium like Tala, it's like, oh, this is amazing. And then you travel around like even Iceland and places like that, and like we were joke in this country with facilities, an absolute joke. Like for a country with so much money, we've so much money coming in from multinationals, coming in from this or that, and that is absolutely sports mad. And then you go to a game in like even Terryland Park, like has massive issues, and that would be seen as one of the good grounds. And you look at the likes of even like Oriel and United Park, and the Showgrounds is would be put forward as one of the good stadia. It's miles behind. Turner's Cross is really, it's just seats, that's it. There's not much else.
There's no money for the developers to do that, so it has to be put in by the people that go, if you want to buy all these houses and make profit off them, put in a facility as well.
Well, we had a lot of correspondence between football and developers in the mid-2000s, and it didn't work out particularly well. You know, like I mean, that always seemed like it would be the solution, and it wasn't. But just a slight tangent, but not really. Like the Evan Ferguson thing, like talk about facilities and how they pay off. Like there's this thing, why are all these Irish players at Brighton? Because Brighton is like a fantastic academy, like fantastic facility.
Other lads left there from Bohemians this week as well.
Yeah, like Jamie Mullins has gone there. Andrew Moran, who also came on and met his Brighton debut in the Premier League during the week, who was at Bray. And like, you know, there's a few other Irish kids have been there or are there at the moment. And that's a club that, like, Brighton, in their own world, like Evan Ferguson was only able to go to England at 16 because his mother's English.
Yeah.
Like, Evan Ferguson should actually only have been... If Evan Ferguson's mother was Irish, he would only have been joining Brighton last week along with Jamie Mullins, who's in his team, or he would have maybe gone to Europe at 16, 17. And this is the problem we have in this country here, that like Brexit is obviously a massive positive in terms of the opportunity it's presented to have more time, but it is this sort of like dilemma. It's a pub debate. Would Evan Ferguson have reached that level by this stage if he'd had to stay at home? until the age of 18. Now, he is that just that naturally talented. He would probably would have done very well.
I have to say no.
But his last last 18 months, he's been able to get the access to Brighton and the not just the coaching, because there's good coaches here, but it's the facilities, it's the ability to the time, everything. And like that is one of these things about Evan Ferguson. It's a real quirk that hasn't really been picked up on. Like,
I think as well,
if on the fact he wants to play football every day, your body's ready at a certain point to go, I can put more into this.
When you
get to that point where you can't contain your energy, you need to train every day. You do.
I think mentally, like I'd say if I were a footballer, I'd get fed up of training all the time. I just get like, what? You know what I mean? Like,
no,
I don't know. Like, you see a lot of players that
stop. You wouldn't, honestly.
More of an insight into Johnny's. You struggle to concentrate on something beyond the period of time.
You touched on Paul Doolan. Like, the training under Paul was excellent. Like, and the group we had was excellent. And I love training. Like, you love it. You look forward to going in every day. You'd stay longer. Like, I was only talking about it with Shane Robinson the other day. But like, we had a gym beside us and in the facility, and we had a table tennis. You wouldn't go home because I lived by myself. I didn't want to go home. Just like being around people, want to train, stay out, do extra, just want to be around people and facility, because you're thinking, I need to take advantage of this while it's here, because we didn't have it because it was part-time at Longford. Other clubs didn't have it. I need to take advantage of this while I have it. And
the other question on him, though, is if he did move to Liverpool, which seems to have been a possibility, where would he be now? And that's interesting for me. Like, can you imagine, like, if Evan Ferguson were coming off the bench for Liverpool now? And I'm not saying he would, but like, it'd be a good time to be coming in. Would he have gotten the chance? Would he have developed as well? I don't know.
When you look at what Liverpool have done, they have put young players into their team. They're not like Klopp, they redone a little bit of their academy as well a few years ago, and they have put a lot of young players in, and they've bought young as well. Some of them aren't coming through the academy, but they have bought young.
You have the kid from Derry, Trent Coney, there, who a lot of people will be very excited about. And again,
he's able to go
at 16 because Derry is in a different jurisdiction.
It's funny, there's question marks as well about some of these younger players, whether they, you know, are going to be at the very, very top level, like Harvey Elliott, Curtis Jones.
So tough.
Cavalli, was the lad they took from Fulham.
Fabio Carvalho.
Yeah.
You know, so it is a long road.
It is.
Maybe Brighton is better because it's just a bit under the radar, a little bit.
I'd agree with you on that, I think. Yeah, I think, I mean, that was Robbie Keane's logic, wasn't it, at his stage, that, like, Evan Ferguson, would he, like, it's a classic one. There's no, we can't prove what would have happened to Evan Ferguson, but I suppose you can probably say with reasonable confidence, like, and what annoyed me a bit last year, like, he was on the bench, like, maybe 15, 16 times for Brighton last year. He was travelling away to prepare for a Premier League game every weekend. Now, he only got a handful of minutes, and sometimes if you're an unused sub and you'd be begging for him to be brought on, even in games where they were, you know, games were done, I think, what harm? And now, clearly, Graham Potter was the manager at the time, they're probably thinking, let's just expose him to this environment.
Just the experience of the environment.
He probably wouldn't have got that at Liverpool at that age, you would think, you know. And like, to what extent has that played a role in his...
That's why I look at Bazunu and I'm thinking to myself, I'm watching a lot of football over Christmas, I'm seeing Bazunu, you know, picking the ball out of the net a lot. Southampton are struggling, I know they won today, but the experience of that, going to these grounds, going to these big stadiums, playing well, saving a penalty as he did at Fulham, is far greater than what Kelleher's experiencing at the moment, in my view.
And even watching how people prepare, like that, I touch on it. Obviously, I used to speak to Michael quite regularly about the players he played with and what he'd done and how he'd done it. And it was just...
Michael Dewberry, is it?
Yeah, that the fan of me as a kid watching these players play, like Desai, I remember the advert to Desai with Adidas, and then all of a sudden I'm playing beside a fella that played with him, and I'm asked him what was he like, and you're having these conversations, and it was that most footballers are fans who become footballers because they love the game, they watch it, they have posters on the wall, they have the 1990 sticker book, all that stuff that makes you want to love it, and then all of a sudden you get exposed to it, and you're trying to be relaxed when you bump into these people, but there's still a bit you're going, I remember watching him play, or I remember watching, or so you're asked, I was asked him, how did these people prepare, and he said, like, he would tell me about how the Italians used to eat their food and what they'd have, and how they were always like stretching and getting massages, and, you know, and how they prepared, that they were always ready to play and stuff, and he said, and he learned from that, and I'm asking him, so that type of thing, that the likes of what Evan Ferguson's getting, being around top pros and watching them how they prepare for games, that experience he's getting, just like you said, exposing them to
the World Cup winner in your
watch what they do and learn, because I might be able to show you or tell you, but when you watch and you see the benefits that that player's getting because he slept right, he ate right, he made sure he was ready to perform, he took in his information, and then that's why he succeeded.
If you want to temper enthusiasm about this, because like I think we need to as well, like part of me is like, I really want this to happen. I think it may well happen. But if he's no issue off the pitch, physically he seems to be developing, what can go wrong for Evan Ferguson right now in the next 3 or 4 years that we're hearing off the ball on one Saturday saying, is he on a patchy run here? Like, what are we going to be like?
Ryan Giggs burst onto the scene and then went through a dip. Michael Owen was the same. Like a lot of these players that come through and burst through, they dip a little bit because there is an element of plateauing. But again, it's learning, right, what's caused me to plateau and how can I fix it and what do I need to improve on. Harry Kane's a great example of a footballer that went out on all these loans and came good. Harry Kane isn't lightning quick. He's not pacey. But he has such game intelligence and his movement in the box is lethal. He's goal the other night,
he's a 10 and a 9.
Yeah, he's goal the other night with his touch bang, the quick release of that shot. He doesn't even have a backlift on his swing, his foot doesn't even come back half a yard, it's just touch bang, the defender can't even get set, doesn't even get a chance to slide, it's gone past the keeper before he makes it. So learning to go, right, well, Evan mightn't be, he'd probably be quicker than Kane, but I need to work on getting shots off in the box quicker like him, or I need to work on my hold of play like him. So it's learning all the time.
And avoiding injuries. Like Harry Kane, what's the longest injury Harry Kane's had? You know, like he...
Is it a few... like ankle problems,
but yeah, but you know,
no career. Well, was a career,
and like he was established when he got them. You know what I mean? I think that's the thing.
And it didn't kill a pace that he didn't have.
Like Adam Eder, to me, is still a great talent. Yeah. Like Adam Eder, like last January, wasn't he played against Everton? And he was looking particularly good, and then he doesn't kick a ball for like 9 months. So, but Evan Ferguson, that's all. Like, I mean, let's be honest. A bit attitude, like, gives you a better chance of making your own luck. But you can still have bad luck with an injury at the wrong time or a change of manager at the wrong time. But I think with Evan, the encouraging thing is that he survived the change of manager. In fact, he's actually thrived from it.
Blackpool have scored again. 2-0 against Nottingham Forest.
You mentioned McAllister as well, JD. So he scored for Brighton. But Evan Ferguson, I don't know. I think we're overhyping him.
I think we're just having a conversation.
He hasn't scored one of the 3 goals that they've scored today anyway. Hopefully he might get one.
I know, but like I think it's just a conversation. We're not building him up to say he's going to be... He's playing the Premiership at a very young age. He's scored in the Premiership at a very young age. I agree a little bit with Johnny saying, if these lads are playing the Premiership, it doesn't automatically say they should play for Ireland. But if they're performing in the Premiership regularly, they have to be then considered to be
right
at the top
level. There will be a clamour.
The difference in the wording is if they're performing in the Premier League.
Say if he scored, like, for example, 4 more goals between now and, say, the Latvia game or whatever. And say then you've like obviously Ida, Pareto, Buffemi, the other kind of Robinson. There will be people saying, yeah, he's got to start. And then Stephen Kenny's like, well, I've no experience of him starting up front for Ireland, let alone in games of the magnitude ahead.
Well, it's particularly as well, this is where the clamour is, of course, people will go for the player of the moment, but a Gardiner playing France, in reality, the challenge in that game is going to be very different for the front man to what Evan Ferguson is facing for sort of a free-flowing Brighton team in great form. Like the number 9, the foremost striker in that game might need to be a really quick player, you know, playing on the break. It might need to be an Ogbeni, you're going to, you know, soak pressure. Like I mean, he has incredible ability. And if he has ability, maybe that will supersede it, it will dominate it all. But it may well be that you want your number 9 for that game to be a real counter-attacker who's defending from the front. Now, I'm not saying he doesn't have the skill set to do that either, but he mightn't be the first person that would spring to your mind. You would think like he's getting a great experience now in Brighton, and he's got a chance to get a run in the team there potentially as the central striker with runners coming off him. But will it be a different role within the Ireland team, even within the within a front two? Like what's his role relative to, like, is he better with Parrott, with Obafemi, with Ogbeni? So these are all the ingredients that come into it. But clearly that will be go out the window in the context of Ferguson has to play, he has to play, he has to play. And Kenny, who's tried a lot of young players, will then be accused of you know, not trying a young player.
We have other sports as well today. Ulster lost 31-29 to Benetton in the URC. And Tamuris at 5-2 won the big race of the day across the pond. The Tolworth Novices Hurdlets and that grade one. Paul Nicholls trained Harry Cobden Road. 5-3-1-6 some texts. on stadia and stadiums and grassroots and all that kind of thing. Took up soccer for the second time in 4 years. GA head in brackets. We haven't had a game since mid-October. Only trained twice. All weather related. Happened the last time I tried to play. The grassroots stinks, says one of our texters. Another one. On grassroots facilities, lads, I manage an underage team of under 14 soccer. Due to rain and a lack of astro pitch availability in Cork, our team have only played two league games. We'll now roll into the summer. There'll be games called off due to congestion when the weather gets better. The lack of facilities is a real problem.
I didn't realise Marie Crowe spoke about this with the young kids. The complexity of games being called off, because Dublin has a different climate to the west of Ireland. I mean, that's blatant. And it doesn't
and Kerry.
You're down in Kerry and it rains not every day, it rains every like 2 minutes basically. Like,
grand if you're inside a 5-star hotel,
you can look out at the rain, but this is a big problem. And like, again, it's the mixed season of playing football in winter. So, I mean, we're going down a long road there, but I mean, it doesn't really make sense to me. But I mean, we'd Shane Keegan on and said, well, you couldn't do that because then like they wouldn't play, they would just abandon football because of Gaelic football and hurling.
Do you think so? Do you think it down in the west of Ireland and in GAA strongholds, they just abandoned football altogether?
A lot would. 100%, yeah, a lot would.
Do you think so, yeah?
It's still a massive problem, particularly I think
my opinion on it, I'm pro any sport, there needs to be a better relationship between the clubs to go, right, we want them to play multi-sports here to a certain extent. Like, so how do we facilitate that they can play football and a Gaelic match on a Sunday and a soccer match on a Saturday, or a football match on a Saturday? I'm not calling it soccer. So and how do we can fit in the training? Like, yeah, they might miss a day's training for whatever, but at least they're still doing something, so they're not missing out on too much in terms of physicality. But you're right, we're not set up to have winter sports in this country. Like, we're just not. We haven't got enough facilities. We haven't got enough indoor domes. We haven't got enough astros. We haven't got enough space to cover the fact that games are just getting called off.
What's a player development? Even, so, like, how can you develop as a player in a bad pitch?
Yeah, and even in terms of, like, and again, as they get older, how do you do? You can't even do, like, even sort of, right, we'll do a bit of tactical work. It's raining. Not that you should be doing tactical work with younger age groups, but there's just no facilities. You go, again, Scandinavia play winter, summer season, but they have indoor halls. Like, so as soon as the weather kicks in, they're indoors training. Like, now Scotland are winter seasons, but every Premiership team in the SPL has undersoil heating, so the matches don't get called off. That's a must. You don't get into the Premiership unless you have undersoil heating.
This game has,
but
been,
you still struggle with facilities.
Yeah. This game has been mad, JD. The chances that Forrest have missed 2-0 down at Blackpool, and it does look like if not a giant killing, it does look like one for the underdogs. Blackpool have kind of, they've had a bit of a smash and grab. Forrest have missed so many chances, and Andy Lyons may well be on track for this will be his first win as a starter. Is this his first game, full stop. So yeah.
5-3-1-0-6. They develop in Brazil and Portugal on sand pitches. No arguments, says one of our texters. Summer football will never work. It's got to go with the school year. Children should not have to commit to sport all year round, says another texter.
So
what? They get 2 week holiday in the summer. So you take your kid away for 2 weeks holiday and you miss 2 weeks of football. And then, but you know what? You can go out and play football from 5 till 10 every evening because the light is there. Like, I was a kid. I used to come home from school, or if I was off school, I'd play football during the day, I'd go training with my team, I'd come back home and I'd go out and play football on the road with my mates. You've too much energy. I just don't.
5-3-1-0-6, I'm from Finglas, and Ireland doing well in the rugby means a hell of a lot. I'm a football fan and an Irish football club with the same coaching structures as Leinster. We'd be a lot better off in terms of producing players. The best rugby academy in the world. Irrelevant of what Johnny Ward thinks, says Michael.
Yeah, fair enough. And I don't.
When did you say? What did you say?
Rugby is a game.
Johnny's relationship with rugby is.
Rugby is a game of a select number of nations. Soccer is the global game. What would the Rugby World Cup get viewing wise compared to the Soccer World Cup, for example?
But
globally,
they don't have to qualify, do they? So only some nations.
It's a small number of teams. Like, I enjoy watching rugby to an extent. You can't compare soccer and rugby. I mean, soccer is a global game. Rugby isn't.
Oh, another one.
Another goal for Blackpool.
CJ Hamilton.
Republic of Ireland. Get international 3-0.
Yeah, Ireland squad.
Yeah.
Why isn't he in the team?
Why isn't he playing?
Ferguson hasn't scored today.
Evan Ferguson has been substituted, as I see. He's been replaced, I think, by Danny Welbeck, but he was involved in one of their first goal.
Latest scores from the FA Cup third round. Blackpool 3, Nottingham Forest 0, as we just said. Bournemouth 0, Accrington 1, Bournemouth 2, Burnley 4. They're doing really well, Burnley, under company. Chesterfield 3, West Brom 2, Fleetwood 2, QPR 1, Hull 0, Fulham 1, Ipswich Town 1, Rotherham 1, Middlesbrough 1, Brighton 3, Millwall 0, Sheffield United 2, and Shrewsbury 0, Sunderland
0. Did you see the clip the other day on the internet with company working with
Luke McNally. Who's actually come off the bench today, McNally.
Yeah, really good it was. Yeah, just talking about how to deal with strikers when they're on the move, that you need to be in motion as well, and your right arm comes out that he doesn't get it. But it was really good. It was really interesting just to see someone like Kompany working with a young centre-back individually, and happened to be Luke McNally, who, if he'd probably be pushing to be in the Ireland squad soon as well.
Well, he hasn't really played a huge amount, but it was a first-half injury that allowed him to come on today. He's a centre-half who joined from Oxford.
That's right, yeah.
Ex St Patrick's Athletic.
We interviewed him last year. Smashing kid.
Yeah, great fella. Another sort of late developer.
Really late, yeah.
Yeah, he wasn't even an exceptional schoolboy, but he's...
He played Gaelic again. This is the thing. He played Gaelic, and that kind of impeded his development in football, so he had those two choices.
Don't ask Jack Grealish though.
But he shot up, Johnny. He shot about 16 to 16 to 18. He grew to nearly 6'2". Mm. Like, he became this presence, and then he's filled out. But
I do genuinely think I don't think there are many countries like Ireland where there's such a clash between two or three sports where you could easily play rugby, football, or Gaelic football, or even hurling. I can't off the top of my head think that in England it doesn't seem comparable. It's probably not much of a crossover between football and rugby. There are only two sports. There are so many alternatives here, and particularly in rural Ireland, where you're kind of brought up to be a Gaelic footballer more so than a soccer player.
England is 12 times the population, and football by miles is their national sport.
Exactly, yeah.
And I think we fight amongst ourselves about it. Like, I think the GAA organisations and people involved in football, we hinder each other because we'll fight for the kid. No, you should just concentrate on soccer. No, you should just concentrate on Gaelic. And I think we specify too early with them, and it becomes nearly a tug of war for them.
And you say in America,
it was once illegal to play both. Yeah. To be fair,
I know
we're talking like 40, 50 years ago, but I mean,
I don't think it was illegal. Now,
what? No, my dad would tell me in Ballyfair.
Prohibited.
The law of one association prevented you. Like, you know, you'd have spotters out there. You know, people.
But you think about it. Even in America, I don't think there's like a clash between like basketball, baseball, and American football per se. I think it's clear at an early age what you're going to play. So it is, we are unique in many respects in sport in this country, and it's a challenge, like, because we lose a lot of players that just don't play anymore.
But we go on about it a bit when Croatia get to the like quarterfinals, semi-finals, like, well, why can't we be like Croatia? And it's almost like, well, like, Ireland are the only country in the world like that has like a clash of sports. Look at Croatia, they have loads of Olympic medals, like in loads of different disciplines and codes.
No hurling.
It's not as if they're just all like, yeah, that's it. They've no hurling. No GAA. Like, all our inter-county players, if they wanted said they could be Premier League footballers if they put their time to it. I mean, this is one of the great discussion points. You know,
I think David Clifford would have been all right. I think he'd have been on.
Yeah, but that, we say that, but then we see like Graham Gartland, Anthony Toho. Like,
they went over really late, though. If you're if David Clifford were basically like trained from the age of three to be a footballer or a soccer player, whatever you want to call it, I'd say it's reasonable to suspect he would have been extremely.
You think it's harder to go? I think it's harder to go the other way. I think it's harder to go from Gaelic to soccer. I think a soccer player could go to Gaelic. Jordan, that I think your skill set in soccer allows you to go to Gaelic. Because you're good with your feet off the ground, you'll pop the ball up, you'll work off both feet, and then it's just about a hand-eye thing with doing so. You're obviously going to be good at keeping up, so that.
David Clifford was a centre half. David Clifford did play for Kerry underage and was a good player. Like, and I've spoken to sort of players who played against him or around him, and you know, there's a split opinion. Like, one or two are convinced he would have gone very far in football if he put.
Who was the lad that played with Jack Bourne that you were talking about?
Keane Lynch, the hurler of the year.
Well, like, there's a couple, but
I found Gaelic easy.
Yeah. You found everything easy.
No, I didn't. No, I struggled with
your media career.
No, yeah. Just bumping into you, found tough. But I found Gaelic that when I went to play it, I thought I got to a stage where I found it quite easy. Mm. Like, I just playing for my skill, I thought this is easy.
There you go. How the debate you never have? How many professional footballers could have been inter-county GAA players? We never talk about that side.
Stephen Bradley got asked to go on
trial. Imagine Brad's
go on trial for Dublin.
What age were you at that time?
I was 16, Stephen was 15. We were playing for...
Any regrets? You could have been like winning All-Ireland?
No, I was like, we just said no. Like,
wouldn't have met a Brazilian
Stephen
woman
had
anyway.
Signed for Arsenal and I had signed for Barnsley, so we were sort of going, there's no point, but we were only playing for the school, and the school ended up doing better than we thought, because we weren't a very good sort of sporting school, a small Jobstown Community College. Like, there wasn't that big a deal, but we got to a quarter final one year and we'd done well, and then they approached us and Stephen was going to Arsenal, I was going to Barnsley, so it was like no, but it was like taking 45s and all and just putting them over the bar and taking free kicks.
I'm sure there's some really
it's just smashed
Stephen
was a joke, because I remember a ref actually blew him up because he soloed it and then hit a half volley and he put the half volley over the bar, like, and it was like a little clip and the ref blew her up, and he was like, and Stephen's going, what are you blowing her up for, like, and he's like, it's a double hop, and he's like, it's not a double. And then I'm arguing for him. I'm going, it's not a double hop. And then I'm thinking, it is a double. Yeah, what? Are you not allowed to do that? And he's like, they're not allowed to do that. And we're going, what? Like, it was mad stuff. We used to have refs going, we just bend over and pick the ball up. And we would go, why? And he'd go, because we just used to do it, tap up with our toe and it pop up. And he'd go, we just had once bend over and scoop her up properly. Like, we just flick her up and pass to each other on the ground and clip across to each other. But it was a football school, because all the lads used to join in and they'd just be like, I remember one lad scored a header in a Gaelic football match. The ref just went,
was illegal, actually.
Yeah, he just came across, bang, diving header, and we all just were like, yeah. And then you look around and he's like, the ref's going free out, and we're like, what? And then you're not allowed. We're like, hey, we're just so oblivious. We're just such a working class school that was like so oblivious to the fact that not allowed to do that. No. Stop. And the ref's just getting so frustrated with us, these Gaelic refs going, we just pick the ball up. Or will you stop hitting half volleys? It was just mad.
Just imagine
just crazy.
Doing rondos in the warm up was a big giveaway, you know?
Yeah, just mad stuff. You laugh about it now, but it was just because you were playing football every day and had that ball, and the ball travelled further, you could kick a Gaelic ball miles.
Yeah.
We'll be back after the break with Graham Gartland, Dan McDonnell and Johnny Ward on the rules of Gaelic football.
Football on off the ball.
With Sky, watch every single live Premier League game this season on Sky Sports, BT Sport and Premier Sports.
This is News Talk.
Let me explain with Sean Defoe.
On this week's episode, what jobs did TDs have before getting elected to the Dáil? Are we really ruled by a cadre of teachers and farmers? And which TD doubles as a whale watching guide? Subscribe now wherever you get your podcasts.
This year, take time to prioritise you. And at Harvey Norman, we have a huge range of connected health devices to get you motivated, reduce everyday stress, and reach this year's fitness goals by giving you new ways to track your progress and stay on track. Like the ultra-slim and lightweight Fitbit Inspire 3 fitness tracker, only €79. Or find new ways to move your body with the Garmin Venue 2 Plus smartwatch with more than 25 preloaded sports apps, only €419. Harvey Norman, your connected health specialists. Go!
Designers and artists with broad imaginations. Architects and specifiers across all of the nations. From wardrobes to beds, our quality can't be denied. One of our innovative products can even be used outside. Outdoor kitchens and games, a summer house with stands, all kinds of weather, all the year round. Through the heat of the summer into cold winter chill. Still a half century later, Medite makes it real. Join the Medite MDF community at meditemakesitreal.com.
So you're saying mental health difficulties can be smaller things?
Yeah.
Like trouble sleeping?
Yeah.
Or if I'm always stressed, like?
Yeah.
Or often anxious?
They're all part of your mental health.
Thought those were separate.
Nope. They're all connected.
Hey, how do you know all this anyway?
Ah, sure, I've been there myself.
Anxiety, ongoing stress, low mood or troubled sleeping, they're all part of your mental health. Make the connection and find support that can help at yourmentalhealth.ie from the HSE.
New year, all new you. Sign up to Air Mobile today and get unlimited calls, texts and no limits 5G data. Plus, choose from any of the Samsung Galaxy S22 series or the S21 FE and claim a Chromebook 4 worth €339. Hurry, offer ends 24th of January. Go in store or visit air.ie. 5G coverage subject to availability. Available on selected bill pay plans. 24-month contract subject to fair usage. For full details and terms, see air.ie.
With the ongoing war in Ukraine affecting the cost of energy, many of us are facing a challenging winter. Through Budget 23, government is introducing a range of supports to lessen the financial impact on families, households and businesses, and will continue to monitor the situation in the coming months to protect those in difficulty. It's important that everyone stays warm and well, but where safe and possible to do so, reducing energy use can also reduce bills. Changes like turning your thermostat down by 1 degree and considering how often you use energy-intensive appliances like tumble dryers can make a big difference. For information on available supports and energy-saving advice, visit gov.ie/reduce-your-use. Brought to you by the Government of Ireland.
Galvin Tullamore Sale now on. Ireland's destination menswear store. Galvin Sale now on.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Sky, get more of the sports you love on Sports Extra with BT Sport and Premier Sports.
This is News Talk.
And welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. John Duggan with you as always until 5 on Football Saturday, the 1st of 2023. Happy New Year to you all. And we're on News Talk across the country, also streaming the conversation on digital, on YouTube, Facebook, the OTB Sports app, as well as Twitter. Joined in studio by the former League of Ireland and FAI Cup winning footballer Graham Gartland, football correspondent of the Irish Independent Dan McDonnell, and a broadcaster and journalist Johnny Ward. FA Cup third round scores, 10 matches kicked off at 3, and in them Blackpool 3 Nottingham Forest 0, Bournemouth 1 Accrington 1, Bournemouth 2 Burnley 4, Chesterfield 3 West Brom 2, Fleetwood 2 QPR 1, Hull 0 Fulham 1, Ipswich 3 Rotherham 1, Middlesbrough 1 Brighton 4, Millwall 0 Sheffield United 2, Shrewsbury 1 Sunderland 0. In Scotland, Celtic are 2-0 up against Kilmarnock in the Premiership, 80 minutes on the watch. Aberdeen 1 St Johnstone 0 is the latest score. Also Ross County 0 Livingston 2 and St Mirren 1 Hearts 1. Just Graham Gartland on Liverpool, what has gone wrong in your view?
I think we touched on it earlier. I think mental fatigue. I think they played every game they could last season, all the way up. They got to the finals of everything. They went to basically the last game of the season, so they had everything to play for. And I think it was a shortened pre-season because of the World Cup. And I think with the high energy that they play with, and they haven't been able to play with that this season, and I think when they're not able to strangle teams the way they used to, they're not able to put the fear into teams where they're constantly on them in terms of even attacking, like one at second and third attack. They're open to more counter-attacks themselves. So their transitions haven't been right. They're not set up for to stop counter-attacks as well, to give them second and third phase attacks, which then tire teams out as well. Teams are able to take a breath against them, which they weren't previously. So they went through a dip like this probably 2 seasons ago. I think it was Alisson's goal in the last game against West Brom puts them into the Champions League. And then they come back from that, make the Champions League final. Like you said, push City all the way to the league, win the FA Cup, win the League Cup as well. So maybe next season they might reset and come back with all the young players that they are bringing in that we touched on as well. But I do think it's mental fatigue. I do think it's physical fatigue as well. I think when you get to that level of performance and that level which the Premiership is at, I think all these factors are taking percentages off. So the mental fatigue, the physical fatigue, the dynamic probably isn't quite right in terms of the likes of Diaz is injured on the left-hand side, which has brought a lot in since Mane left. The midfield hasn't been quite right.
Is that the biggest problem in the midfield? You've got the Henderson's miles on the clock now. Fabinho didn't play much part in the World Cup. Elliot is seen as maybe a bit too young, and maybe is he good enough? They have a lot of strengthening to do there.
Yeah, I think Graeme Souness touches on this really well. Like Liverpool's team, their midfield were very workmanlike. There wasn't a lot of guile in them in terms of like top end of the pitch producing like small little intricate through balls. Thiago has brought a little bit of that, but he's more of a controlling player in terms of getting passes from the back line and linking the play rather than producing through balls. A lot of their sort of creativity comes from Trent on that side, Robertson as well at times. But they've been workmanlike. They're honest. They're in touch with their front line. They're in touch with their back line. The distances at the moment are probably a little bit too much for them to cover because the back line can't get up a little bit because the pressure from the front isn't as high as it was. You can't play a high line if there's no pressure on the ball. You can't play a high line if the midfield can't get in touch with the strikers, because now there's gaps for the opposition midfield to come and collect. So I think all of these factors have just diminished them by your percentages. And when you're playing in the probably the toughest league in the world in terms of its intensity, I'm not talking about quality here, I'm talking about intensity, constant intensity. Them little percentages add up, and that's why they're probably not hitting the heights that they did last season.
Can Arsenal do it?
I think they'll have a go at it. I think getting over the line is a big thing for them. I've seen that when your previous guests were talking about winning and how to win, from how to basically get over the line from winning position. They haven't many players maybe that have gone through that with Arsenal because they haven't won in so long, but they have to be there to do it. So they're going to have to give themselves a chance. I know there's a lot of talk about Arteta's antics on the sideline, but it just shows that he's invested in the team and he wants to, like Klopp done it a few years ago as well. Guardiola done it, has done it at Anfield on numerous occasions. Ferguson has done it as well. The difference is that these lads have been successful and then they were doing it, where obviously he's trying, but I don't think that's an issue.
When you're looking at City, though, the squad depth that they have, they brought Grealish on, Mahrez on against Chelsea, both involved in the goal, Rico Lewis even coming on, they've got Alvarez to come, you'd have to think that they have probably the better squad, guys.
Yeah, you would. Like, I mean, and Arsenal have a tricky run of fixtures coming up.
Yeah.
I mean, I know there's the Spurs game, and then they have Man City is, Man City, Man U is next weekend.
That's right, yeah.
So, like, but I think I was actually just looking at the fixtures, just trying to get a handle on that City actually have a tricky enough run, but then they have a stretch where a sequence where you could see them
10 in a row,
you know, and Arsenal, you sort of think, right, if they can match City or get ahead of them, you know, extend the gap again, then who knows? Like, I've watched a bit of Arsenal over Christmas, and because I haven't really been that grabbed by the Arsenal story the last couple of years. Every year,
are you now?
Arsenal, a little bit, yeah. I think they're good to watch. You know,
Odegaard's quality.
Really enjoy watching them, and like, you know, Saka is a top player.
Yeah,
he really is, and Martinelli at the other side, and even like Nketiah coming in, maybe because they played Dundalk a couple of years back in the Europa League, and there were a couple of the younger players were involved then, Nketiah and Smith Rowe, maybe followed them a little bit more. But actually, like, he's done okay in the absence of Jesus, and seems to be a bit of a crowd favourite. Now, you presume they'll have to do something in January.
Yeah, yeah,
you know, and the Mudrick sort of, I don't know, was it a tug of war between them and Chelsea, the Ukrainian player, sort of be interested in him because he was playing against Ireland last year, and he's a bit of a talent as well. So, but he's quite an exciting player as well too. So whatever happens this season, you think they've got the age profile to be around for a long time. Like, what I find interesting is that City in the summer, I know they let Sterling go to Chelsea as well, but they let Zinchenko and Jesus go to City, and you're almost thinking, these probably aren't really a threat, you know, in the sense that can you imagine them selling two players to Arsenal this summer?
Like, could you imagine them selling some players to Liverpool? When you consider that they were the biggest threat to them in the last couple of seasons.
It shows about
the
systems. This Guardiola is all about the system. If you fit in the system or you don't, whereas these guys maybe got a bit of liberation out of going to Arsenal.
But it's true, but it's even just that City were able to let them go to that club. Like, they don't need to sell. I know, ostensibly financial fair play exists, I mean, in a very a la carte way, and you have to balance the books in some ways. But I think Arsenal, it's an easy enough story to get behind and get into.
I agree what you're saying. Guardiola's system and it's football and it's passing and it's a lot of small little passing movement, I think, and a lot of control in the game. And like,
that's the problem being the last couple of years when they've gone off autopilot, they've struggled.
And I see that. I think obviously Arteta's worked at Man City and worked with Guardiola before he got the Arsenal job, and you can see elements of just the way he wants to play and the control he brings. But I also see a freedom to their movement that they're so willing to run forward. And when you have that youth in your team, and Odegaard is the one that links it, that he's releasing that, and that when you're 23, 24 and you're willing to run that way, and you have players that want to produce and put passes in front of you to run onto, that's where I find Arsenal a little bit better to watch than Man City. I enjoy that style a little bit more than I do watching Man City, who probably have a lot more control in the game and can actually just suffocate teams and death by a thousand cuts type of thing. I like watching Arsenal in the last probably few months, where they've young players, they've got good playmakers in the team, they're willing to run forward, they're aggressive in what they do, and they're actually really good to watch lately.
Just on Liverpool, JD, one thing that is interesting is they have a lot of aging players sort of top to bottom in the team that are probably in decline, and they don't seem to have like all these ready-made replacements. Like Nunes, I'm still not fully sold on. And with the battle for the top four now, you wonder if they miss out on the top four this season, are they going to just splash the cash in the summer? Because they are falling quite a bit behind at the moment. Like their fall from grace has been more dramatic than I thought. But you look at like Van Dijk probably isn't the player he was. I would say Salah isn't the player he was, which is understandable. Again, Henderson definitely not the player he was. And I don't know. Like this could be a time when Liverpool are going to go into a bit of a slump for
the ownership situation is obviously going to be central to what happens.
And will Klopp just go? Klopp just strikes me as the kind of guy who might just leave.
Yeah, because I think it's a big rebuilding job as it is now as well, and maybe he's done his job there.
Yeah, he did sign the new deal, but
I do feel sorry for the fans in one sense that
I don't think they can splash the cash, Johnny. Yeah. I know that sounds.
He's just bought Gakpo, but Gakpo could be good. In fairness,
he's the player they want.
The Nunes signing for me is a funny one in the sense that he doesn't really look like the type of player that would fit that system. But I think with Klopp now, he might say that I've done enough. The one thing I would feel sorry for the fans is they didn't really get to celebrate winning the league when it was that.
Look, they won enough trophies.
Yeah, they did. But Liverpool fans of my vintage, I started supporting Liverpool when I was after they'd won the last league title. So I hadn't seen them win a league. And there are a lot of Liverpool fans around the age of late 30s, 40, particularly in Ireland, massive support. And then you have over there where it was they did win the league, but it wasn't quite the same.
Do you think Arsenal stay the course as a Spurs man, John?
No, but they'll definitely finish top four, but they don't have the squad in my view.
No.
They almost have to be added
every
game.
Spurs are going to finish second, JD. This is
a new year. I don't know what I've said in the past.
The year was meant to happen. This is the year meant to happen. And Arsenal coming to it. I should mention Andy Lyons is going to win. Promise Omacher, his old Bowes teammate, looks to have got the winner for Fleetwood against QPR in the FA Cup. And Danny Mandrew, former teammate of Lyons at Bowes and Rovers, has scored for Lincoln today.
He's a talented player.
Of Omacher at Bowes.
Yeah, I mean, do you think that all those players were at Bowes together at one time? You throw in Dawson Devoy and the number of them, even Kieran Kelly, who's gone to Bradford, the amount of them that are now
Longer's listening and saying, well, how could I keep just how could I keep bringing
in players? Both teams that played in 2020, you'd love to wear it now.
Kevin's.
Kevin's players.
All Kevin's players, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Arsenal bench against Newcastle was Fabio Vieira, Marquinhos and Nathan Butler. Oh, yeah, JD. So, in terms of front players, I'm not so sure if they have it. As we go into the closing stages of the show, Graham Gartland was speaking about Gaelic football. How would that guy fare in hurling? No chance, I guess.
No. What's that guy? He knows me now.
Jesus, you.
But no, I wouldn't add that. Hold on, the completely different topic here. I never mentioned hurling. The completely different skill set. I was rubbish at hurling.
Jeez, you're clueless to listen to. We're not even halfway through the season. Liverpool will easily finish in the top four and probably win the Champions League, says Pork. Well, it's all about opinions, Pork. But,
we never mentioned the Champions League. I never said they wouldn't finish in the top four. I think they'll finish in the top four. But
look how they played against Brentford. I think they'd be doing well to win the Champions League the way they played against Brentford the other night.
Even against Leicester, they were desperate. They got two own goals and they won the game. And Brentford were 5-1 to beat them. I was like, what? Liverpool are not good at
that.
One thing is, though, there is fewer games because of the break. We're thinking it's January, but obviously we're behind.
Can they recharge, though? I don't. They should have been able to recharge in the off season. And it's funny.
They couldn't recharge in the off season. A shorter off season. That's what I said.
They've had a lot of players who didn't go to the World Cup as well.
Yeah.
Love the FA Cup, but as a Newcastle fan, I'm feeling very conflicted. It's been 20 odd years of negativity and obvious disgust now at the ownership. That said, there's a lot to like about the current team. It's an unusual feeling of confidence that they should win today. After the change of ownership, I said I wouldn't support them, but it's harder than I thought. That's the dilemma, isn't it?
Very honest, yeah.
I'll tell you, I saw Newcastle against Spurs live. They are the real deal. Eddie Howe, super manager, really well organised.
They're a top four team.
There's a lot, because I've seen a discussion about the likes of Lampard struggling at Everton and, a big name player who had a fantastic career. But do they make good managers? And obviously the likes of Eddie Howe, who probably didn't have and even Graham Potter, for example, who probably didn't have as good a career as these lads, but then go into management.
You'd have some sympathy for Lampard as well, in the sense of how good are Everton anyway? Should they be doing an awful lot better? I don't know.
He said some of these players aren't good.
There's a legacy of 4 to 5 different managers and different players and players on inflated contracts. And what are you then working with as a manager like Frank Lampard? So, but will Sean Dyche come in? You never know.
The Potter thing's interesting as well in that, like, will they give him time? He's a lot of bad luck with injuries.
I think his contract is...
It would suggest
the message seemed to
be
they'd be patient. I mean, it is a slightly different Chelsea administration to the one before, but whether that doesn't mean...
I think I also took away that going at Brighton. I was thinking about this today, is that I remember his first year at Brighton, he took a lot of flack for playing okay football, but with no cutting edge and no end product, and again, wasn't great to watch and all this stuff. And then... obviously the start of this season, Brighton started really playing fantastically well, and like you said, the facilities they have. So I think he deserves a bit of time at Chelsea as well, you know, but I think he's shown that given time he can turn teams into a good watch, and hopefully then they'll be successful for Chelsea.
5-3-1-0-6, you're so Dublin-centric, folks. Felix Patterson also came on for Fleetwood for his debut, says John.
Didn't see that. Yeah, saw him play plenty for Waterford last season.
Irish, though. We're talking about Irish players.
He's not Irish, but Scottish. He's a good player, yeah.
He's so English-based, that guy, that commented.
Fleetwood signed somebody else in the League of Ireland.
David Harrington.
The goalkeeper.
David Harrington, yeah. That was one that surprised me.
Is he on the bench?
I don't know, actually. I'm not sure.
Fleetwood is definitely...
they did some great ads, ads.
If they would, they'd certainly be signing League of Ireland players every other day.
Johnny Walters is now the technical director of both Fleetwood and Waterford.
They're
off to Dubai for pre-season.
Wonder how they
got Fleetwood. All the lads used to head off to Mosny, and now, like...
we went on a few pre-season trips. Yeah, we went to Spain twice, went to Turkey once. Yeah, they were good.
Who did you play against? How many more names can you drop before the show?
We're running out of time.
I remember getting sent off in a pre-season friendly. Wasn't good.
Blackpool 4, Nottingham Forest 1 as a result in the FA Cup third round. Bournemouth 1, Accrington 1 as a result. Today's scores: Bournemouth 2, Burnley 4, Chesterfield 3, West Brom 3, Fleetwood 2, QPR 1 a result. These are all results now coming. Hull 0, Fulham 2, Ipswich 4, Rotherham 1, Middlesbrough 1, Brighton 5, Millwall 0, Sheffield United 2, Shrewsbury 1, Sunderland 2, half 5 kickoffs, Brentford, West Ham, Coventry, Wrexham, Grimsby, Burton, Luton, Wigan, 6 o'clock, Sheffield Wednesday, Newcastle, and then 8 o'clock, Liverpool against Wolves. Dan, Graham and Johnny, delighted to have the pleasure of your company today. Thanks so much, lads.
Thanks, JD.
Speak to you soon. Got to leave it there, folks. Don't forget, Off the Ball back tomorrow, 1-7. Joe Malloy in the chair, as always, here on News Talk. Got to catch up with the recently retired jockey Davy Russell for an interview. Our guests on the Sunday paper review are Sinead O'Carroll and Cliona Foley. We'll also bring you the latest from the All-Ireland Club Football Semi-Finals. Be sure to join us tomorrow on your radio for all the regular updates and some great chat. If you missed any of the Saturday panel previewing the sporting year with Roy Curtis, Tim McCarthy and Maura Trastini-Kelly, or any of OTB Football Saturday with Graham Gartland, Dan McDonnell and Johnny Ward, you can find the podcast of our content on the OTB Sports app, or be sure to listen back wherever you get your pods. Thanks so much for listening to us on your radio across the country here on News Talk today. We'll speak soon. Bye bye.
Give him a ball and he had a grass. He'll give you a move for the perfect pass. Give him a ball and he had a spice. He'll give you a move with godly grace.
We're on Twitter. Just look for @NewsTalkFM for the latest updates.
This year, take time to prioritise you. And at